dusty mesa, a looming shadow grows hidden in the branches of the poison creoso. She twines and climbs up slowly towards the boiling sun, and when I touched her skin, my fingers ran with blood.
Here is Jared Fogle. You may have seen him on the news or a talk show. He was inspired by Subway's great-tasting sandwiches. Jared believes in an active lifestyle, including lots of walking. At the heart of Jared's routine are Subway sandwiches.
Hey, Jared.
Hey, guys.
At Subway, you can choose from 7 sandwiches with 6 grams of fat or less, and they all taste great. Food for thought. Subway. It's the way a sandwich should be.
This program is brought to you by Subway, the way a sandwich should be.
Come on. Okay, let's bring Tina in here.
Are we live?
We're live.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Tim Dillon New Year's Eve Spectacular here. We're very excited. It's been a fun year for everyone. I don't want to hear any negativity. It's just been great. Sure, people have had their issues, but you know what? At the end of the day, you don't need that. We don't need that negativity. One of our favorite people, the great Tina 40, from the Bronx, New York. Thank you for coming on, Tina. Happy New Year, motherfucker.
That's right. Happy New Year, motherfuckers. How you doing?
New Year, Tina.
Happy New Year, Tina. You were fucking wild. What do you got going on? You got a march on January 6th, right?
Yes, I have a march on January fucking 6th.
And you're not worried about Antifa. You don't care about any of these people.
Oh, fuck Antifa, please.
You're bringing an army.
Fuck Antifa. Yeah. Fuck Antifa, yeah, you know how that goes.
Yeah, you're a tough girl from the Bronx. You don't
That's
care.
Right. I don't take shit.
You don't take shit from anybody.
I don't take shit. I don't hide. I don't cover my face. I don't wear a black hood on my head.
Right.
I feel loud and proud.
Loud and proud.
That's right.
Yeah, I fucking love it. But you got a shirt on that makes you look like a hippie, but you're not a hippie.
I know I'm not a hippie.
Yeah.
my daughter bought me this shirt. I had to wear it.
Have you ever done DMT, Tina?
When did you get into the political stuff? When would, because you're an athlete. You do a lot of work.
I do Spartan races. I run Spartan races all over the United States.
And those are, what are those races? Like a Tough Mudder?
Oh, yeah, they're Tough Mudders. They're real hard. I do the 15-mile ones. I carry wounded warriors on the course. I climb mountains. I swim through fucking lakes. I run through mud.
You carry soldiers on your back?
What do you mean you carry wounded warriors? You carry...
I put them on my shoulder to do the monkey bars because some of them, you know, their legs amputated and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I carry the wounded warriors, and I carry a World War II vet on the course, too, like a
is that what a Spartan race is? You're just carrying World War II vet, like carrying elderly people?
No, those are the honor series.
Do they ever get a little out of line? There's World War II vets?
I got my medal spawn tattooed on my arm.
Oh, lovely.
Now, what is that tattoo?
It's my Spartan medal.
Oh, Spartan medal. Now, do you?
Yeah.
Well, very good. That's very nice. What a terrifying tattoo. That's a scary.
it's
a very
it's a, Roman. It's a Spartan helmet.
Yeah, that's yeah, it very. Is. Yeah, it looks like prison ink. So now,
I have a lot of it.
Yeah. Now, what are you doing January 6th? What is the march for, and who's going to be meeting?
January 6th is basically patriots from all over the country are coming. We're going to be at the Capitol. I'll be there about 6-7 a.m. in the morning. I'm doing an unveiling.
You're unveiling. What are you unveiling?
Unveiling a surprise.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is it an act of domestic terrorism?
It's
going to surprise the FBI? Who's going to be surprised?
It's dedicated to my slur of the house, Nancy Pelosi. It's a dedication just for her.
Okay.
It's just for that drunken slurring cunt. Can I say that?
Sure. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but you worked for Andrew Cuomo at one point, right?
No, I never worked for him. Get the fuck out of here. You worked for him?
I got wrong.
What do you think about Cuomo? How do you feel about him?
Cuomo is a corrupt commie cunt.
Yeah.
And I have no use for him. He's a jerk off. I protested plenty of times in Albany. I've been to Manhattan. I protest. I ran up on the Christmas tree a couple of weeks ago.
You climbed the Christmas tree?
Yeah, the Christmas tree that they now make New Yorkers fucking pay for. The fuck out of here. I took my crew, my little flag drop crew, and we walked right into where the tree was being shown. We cut the whole line, walked in there with fucking Trump flags. Fishy, 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 driving all the liberals crazy.
Oh, did you climb the tree?
Did you get out? Did you light it on fire?
No, but I did stand in front of it and I made a live video like, hey, de Blasio. Hey, Cuomo.
Now, do you think the FBI or people like that tap your phone? Because you're pretty,
I don't know. I mean, if they do, they must get a good laugh, I would say. I mean, I am very serious. I do take my politics serious. I curse and everything because that's my passion.
That's part of it.
But I wouldn't harm anybody, but I will come in your face.
Are you afraid that they would kind of like treat you like a Julian Assange or Edward Snowden?
Do you think you're going to be a political prisoner? Kamala Harris is going to lock you up somewhere?
Yeah, definitely. I can see Cuomo knocking on my door, but he'll need a fucking army.
Yeah.
Okay? How do you like that?
Now, you're a Bronx. You're born and raised in the Bronx?
Yes, I'm born and raised in the Bronx.
All right. Very good. Throg's Neck.
Throg's Neck.
Right by the bridge?
Right by the bridge. Nice. And you're are you Italian?
I'm Italian.
Okay, so this Cuomo thing, that's a betrayal to you because that's one of your brothers.
Him and his brother, Fredo. Yeah, he's a real piece of shit. He destroyed New York. He destroyed it completely.
Now, you're a tough woman. You lift weights and all that. Yeah. What's your take on that whole weightlifting controversy?
Yeah, with him with the fake, you see the fake barbell?
That's fake. You know what? I offered to go on fucking Cuomo's show, and I told him I would bench press him.
Right.
He never took me up on it.
Me up on it. Well, he's a coward.
Yes, he is.
Now, have you ever met Trump?
No, I haven't met Trump, but I met his family. With his family, with his sister. I did meet his family. I have met people. I've met Bernie Carrick.
Have you met Barron?
Have you met Giuliani?
I met Giuliani.
Okay. Now, do you think there's any way that Trump pulls this out, or is it? It's looking pretty bleak.
I know. It's actually, he won in a landslide. We all know he won. We all know that it was stolen. It just look. You're laughing. I see you fucking laughing at me.
Yeah. Well,
laughing.
He's a liberal, Tina. He's a fat.
You're a liberal.
Oh my God!
I'll kick your fucking ass.
You gotta get in here and beat the shit out of him, Tina. Well, you couldn't carry him on your back, this fat fuck.
Look, I'll grab you. Giuliani had a lot
of prestige. I can drag you around
I'd love to.
I'll drag you for your flight.
You come right after me.
I'll drag you right through the mud.
How would you come at me? Like, what would be the move?
What would I do to come at you? I would come right at you. Right to the floor. All right. I would plow you right down in the ground.
I'm a big guy.
By your fucking feet. I don't give a shit. The bigger you are, the harder you fall.
Okay.
I would knock you down and drag you by your feet.
I believe it.
And that's beautiful. I think that's a beautiful American moment that we have there. So do you think Trump will run again in 2024?
Yes. If they do not certify the election for him on the 6th, I think he will be announcing a 2024 election.
Would you support him maybe going to a different country and running for their president?
Yeah, would that be good?
Maybe like Venezuela.
I think I actually would like to see the no more Democrats and no more Republicans. I'd like to see a new party.
That's a great idea.
I voted for Ralph Nader twice.
Really, a Patriot Party, because no one speaks, no Democrat or Republicans. They don't speak for we the people. Donald Trump is the first person to actually give us a voice. So I feel that a new party should be made. I would run myself.
Would you ever go down there to Mar-a-Lago to do some golf or anything?
No, I would go down there to do a flag drop.
Now, what is a flag drop?
A flag drop, we have a 75 by 50 foot flag that we walk all over the city with.
Oh.
And D.C., it's huge. We walk, it says Trump on it, and then it says law and order.
Oh, so it's not an American flag. It says
do you use the flag?
It's not an American flag. It's law and order.
Right. It's right. It's a Trump flag. It's an American flag, but it says Trump War and Order on it. And we walk in. You never saw the videos of me with everybody like that. There's like hundreds of us. We drag it down the street. We walk through Times Square. We get bottles thrown at us. Everything. They attacked us when we're doing it.
Does stuff happen underneath the flag? Do you like hit people under the flag?
So people do try to come at us. You can run underneath it because yeah. they're actually coming.
That's what we thought we were picturing. We pictured people kind of going in underneath.
Yeah, I did. Four kids tried to jump me once.
It yeah. was yeah.
I turned around. I go, but how old are you? You're not even old enough to fucking vote. You're jumping me? Really?
It's crazy, the people yeah. out there with the violence.
Yeah, it is.
And you guys, all you guys want is respect for law and order.
Yeah,
no matter what, no matter what they do, you always have yeah. to respect them, even if they shoot. Yeah, you gotta respect. Yeah.
You have to agreed. Respect them.
And that makes a lot of sense. And why are people so against that? Why are people so against like the cops kind of coming, you know, in their house and doing law and order?
Well, no, I wouldn't want them coming in my house.
Okay, so wait a minute. Why not? Hold on.
That's violating our constitutional rights. They can't just knock on my door and come in my house. That's what Cuomo threatened us. So if you have more than six people in your house, we're coming to your house on Thanksgiving. Come to my fucking house on Thanksgiving. Let me see you try to get in my house on Thanksgiving. You're going to tell us we can't have Thanksgiving. We can't have Christmas. We can't have any celebrations. Yet he's gonna go host a fucking game, what he just announced today. He's going to have 6,000 people in a stadium. At a game. Meanwhile, we couldn't go see anybody at a funeral. We couldn't go see. I was in the hospital in March for 2 weeks. I almost died with COVID? I almost died in March. I couldn't have any family visiting.
Hold on. Hold on a minute. You almost died of COVID?
Yeah, I did.
What? Yeah. Wait a minute.
Yeah, I did.
What happened? You're a healthy young woman.
Yeah, I know. And look what happened. I was celebrating my 50th birthday, March 7th.
Okay.
And about a week later, I started not feeling well. I had 104 fever.
Okay.
And I have underlying asthma, So for me being healthy, I think that's what saved me. So I had 104 fever. I had a sore throat. I had my chest was congested. I went to the doctor and she said, you know what, Teen, you don't have the flu. You don't have strep throat. I'm going to give you a COVID test. I was like, the coronavirus? You think I got that shit? So she gives me the test, the swab up the both nose. She calls me back 2 days later. She goes, Tina, you tested positive. I'm going to call you in hydroxychloroquine and the Z-Pack.
Right.
And my pharmacy calls up and tells me, can't give it to you because Cuomo signed an executive order. I go, who the fuck is he to tell me what medicine my doctor can prescribe me?
I agree about that 100%.
And 3 days later, I end up in the hospital dying with double pneumonia and blood clotting.
Jeez.
Thank God you're alive.
But you're alive right now.
I'm alive right now.
How do you feel about masks?
I don't like masks. I don't wear masks. Masks don't fucking work. They don't work. It says it right on the fucking box. It says right on the box.
That really is a phenomenal country. I mean, you're a resilient person. You don't care. You came out of the hospital and you're now fighting for other people's rights to kind of go out and not wear the mask.
I yell at people. I take your fucking mask off. Breathe the fresh air in. I tell them.
The droplets. You don't buy that at all.
I don't buy that at all. In fact, what I'm gonna start doing in New York is when we come back the 6th from D.C., we're having a big protest in the city the 10th for all the lockdowns and stuff. And then I'm gonna start doing maskless mobs, 50 to 100 people at a time running into Walmarts. And Costco's
just giving people COVID.
No, you don't get COVID like that. I don't have antibodies. I want to show them that you don't have to be afraid of me. Like
these maskless mobs sound a lot of fun.
Are you gonna cough on people and like spit on them?
No, that I won't do. But you know what? People shouldn't be afraid. I have antibodies. I'm not afraid to be on the same. There's a second strain and.
Who gives a shit? So what? You go to the hospital again? Who cares?
Right, I go in again. Fuck you.
Did you say motherfucker to the doctor when he walked in?
You know what I did say when I did wake up in the morning?
Yeah.
I said, anything that's made in China, get it the fuck out of my room. That I did say. So I basically had to leave everything out of the room.
So 2021, you're excited. You got maskless people running into Walmart in New York City. Maybe a few more Spartan races.
Oh, yeah. April starts my season. God willing, right. They open everything else.
Well, very good. Well, Tina, you have anything else? Because she's amazing.
I mean, I just admire your spirit. We don't agree on everything, but I admire your spirit. Listen,
we can agree to disagree. I love sure. that.
I agree with everything you've ever said and everything Thank you'll say you. In the future, which I don't even know what it is, but I yes. agree with it. Because you. It takes a strong spirit to have had the COVID and not let it break you and go out and get 100 people to run into a Walgreens without masks. That's a strong person.
You might want to bring some knives.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to get, who knows?
Get a little dicey.
No, they're afraid. They're going to be like, this. Please put your mask on. We're scared. Get away. Oh,
right. Yeah.
I've had women approach me before. I had some woman, she looked like she had bloomers on her fucking face. She came up to me, she's like, where's your mask? I go, well, if your bloomers on your face works, what are you worrying about me having a mask on for? Go away.
Right. Well, we wish you a happy new year and tell Thank people you. Where they can follow you, Real Tina 40 on Instagram.
Real Tina 40 on Instagram, Twitter, Paula, Facebook. I just made a TikTok. And I have a message for you. Chrissy Mayer says hello. I have yes. to say that to you.
Chrissy's a fun girl. I remember Chrissy's a funny lady. She's in New York.
Thank you for having me. So many people told me you mentioned me and I was
You're the funniest. You're so funny. You're almost like a comedian a little bit. Because you're very funny.
Thank
you. You're kick ass and you don't care. I had no idea you had COVID, but it's just another layer. It makes it very interesting. So listen, God love you and Godspeed. And
thank you. Happy New Year.
Good luck with the mobs and intimidating the governor. I'm all for it.
That's right. The 2020 isn't over yet. So Trump 2020, motherfucker. Fuck out of here.
There she is. Tina 40, everybody.
Amazing. Good night, guys. Take
Amazing.
Care.
A legend. I mean, what a country.
Look, this is it's the first country of ideas.
I almost died, motherfucker. I had COVID for 2 years.
Jesus Christ. This thing's a monster. This thing is a literal monster.
This is Ray Kump. Most people have had the feeling that this is literally Raymond Kump.
This thing is trying to die.
No, it's that people say the same thing about you.
I know.
Tina 40, what an amazing woman. I mean, just got out of the hospital with COVID. She's going to have 100 people without masks run into places. I mean, that seems like not a great idea.
Yeah. No, Jesus Christ. Look, I mean, I admire the... I'd like to be there to see it.
I want to see it, too. Yeah.
I mean, I get her angle. I don't know what you're doing, like running up into people's faces, telling them to put their mask... I mean, just stay away. But, you know,
yeah.
But, no, I like the idea of her just spitting and coughing blood on people and, you know...
I just love the idea that she was in the hospital for COVID. She doesn't give a shit.
Right.
She doesn't care.
I almost died.
I almost died, motherfucker. Who cares?
It's a
disturbed country. This is how it... We're on the way out
look,
here.
We gotta look at who broke our brains.
Right.
Because that's what, at some point, we just became a fractured shell of a country. But, you know, we're on the up and up, I think. I think we're pulling that out.
Yeah, we're on the up and up.
2021 is going to be our year.
Me and Ray are trying to lose weight in the new year, and we have some real interesting ways to do it. We're going back to 90s diets.
Yeah.
We don't feel like we can really do these keto and the paleo and all this shit. We need to go back to real 1990s diets that failed all of our parents.
I'm sick of this berries and like dry meats and like, you know, I need, what's nice about the 90s.
Yes.
Is that it was a concierge diet.
Yes.
They like, oh, you want cookies? We'll make a cookie.
Yes. Whatever you want.
You want a milkshake every 3 times a day? We can do that.
We got that. Hey, as long as you're accountable, you just have to be accountable.
Yeah.
You just have to be accountable. So the 90s diets were like, you can have a slice of chocolate cake. You also just have to have a glass of water.
The 90s were all about you decide what's reasonable.
Yeah. You make the decisions that you've been failing at making forever. You can make them with our diet plan.
Yeah.
It was about choice. The 90s was about choice.
Yes.
Yeah. So we have this diet here that we're really excited about. And this was called Deal-A-Meal. I don't even know if we can still get it.
I look, you have to go on eBay probably.
God, I hope.
Find some dead guy Deal-A-Meal.
I hope we can get it because this is a real phenomenal diet that allows us to really maximize.
Deal-A-Meal divides the food groups into 6 colors of playing cards. Meats are red, veggies green, fruits pink, dairy blue, fats yellow, and breads brown.
Opiates
start the
are
day with the set
purple.
Number of cards on the left side of your deal a meal wallet. Every time you eat, you buy your food by moving the appropriate card to the slots on the right. When you're out of cards on the left, you're done eating for the day. With these cards, you can finally control your.
By the way, Richard Simmons was involved in every scam diet.
It's a diet for like guys who are addicted to scratch offs.
Yeah, it's a diet for degenerate gamblers.
Hey, you buy it. It's like you're playing poker.
Yeah. So every and by the way, everyone behind him in this infomercial is fat.
Oh yeah.
And he's like, "Does Deal a Meal work?" They're like, "Does it work?" And they're all fat. And this is based on the idea that you couldn't not shove food in your face. Right. So what you had to do is buy a wallet. You have a Deal a Meal wallet,
right,
where you would have cards of meat and poultry and fish. And then you would put one from one part of your wallet to the other part. And then when all the cards were done, you were done eating for the day.
So you go like a TGI Fridays.
Yeah.
And you have the waitress there. And you're like trying to make it. Oh, hold on a second. Let me pull out my Deal a Meal. Can I have the fajitas? And you're like, oh, hold on, Tina. Hold on. I got this.
Let me see. I got to make a good investment.
Can you lend me a fat card?
Let me. Yeah. Can I have a cheat card? I want to. So let's see some more of this.
Really work? Tammy, what do you think?
Well, Richard, I have tried every diet, and none of them have worked. Then I saw your ad for Deal a Meal, so I thought I'd give it a shot.
Well, what happened?
I lost 120 pounds.
Tammy looks like she was in Project Monarch. These are like CIA plans.
Tammy is wearing a blue muumuu. Tammy's like, Richard, I've tried every deal under the sun. And he's, and by the way, not even like the lies aren't even reasonable. Yeah. She's like, and how much weight did you lose? She's like 385 pounds on Deal a Meal.
How many of like just massive, like 800 pound people who die and they have to put them in like a piano box? Yeah. How many of them, if you go through the house, you find like three Deal a Meals?
There's a ton of them. My mother did all this shit, Nutrisystem, Slim Fast, all the bullshit, and none of it worked. And what's great about this Deal a Meal is there's actually nothing different. You're just putting a card in a wallet.
Right.
There's nothing different that you're doing. It's not reforming your diet any real way.
I know. Like it's just, in theory, it's portion control. But what's really going on is I can just pizza. How many cards is this worth? And you, it's just.
Hi, it's me, Richard Simmons, and this is my brand new 94 Deal a Meal. You've seen it on TV, well, now it's in stores, and it's helping millions of people lose weight.
I lost 154 pounds. I've lost 184.
173 for me.
277. Thanks, Richard. In 94, wait.
It's like this is a new 94 Deal a Meal. Look, the old one, I gotta admit, we screwed the cards up. People died, but we figured it out. Here's the new revamp.
Yeah. The old one, there's some class action lawsuits. They're being worked out, but the new one is revamped. Yeah, it's just amazing to watch. Clearly gay, dude.
Oh,
clearly gay. But did he ever come out?
No, I think he's been he's been missing, right, for like 15 years.
My friend's grandmother, my friend's mother-in-law is a serious closeted lesbian.
Okay.
Never had a dude, whatever. Do you know who her first boyfriend was? Richard Simmons.
No.
Swear to God. She lives in LA. She's an older, very tough, businesslike woman. You're like clearly a dyke. And I can say that because I'm fat.
What kind of dates would you take her on?
But I don't know. But they like literally were dating. Like Richard Simmons and this woman were dating.
How funny would it be if like he just butches up as soon as he's up, the cameras turn off? Yeah. And he's like, all right, let's get these fatties.
Go get a steak. No, but I mean, first of all, how embarrassing is it if you dated Richard Simmons and you're not a lesbian?
Yeah.
Like how embarrassing would it be if you got fooled by Richard Simmons? Right. Like you were like, yeah, I thought he liked pussy. What was the indication?
He might lay pipe hard. You don't know.
He probably does, but to a Filipino pool boy.
I'm just saying, he takes out some with his cock. And he's just, look, certain guys like him, I feel like they can just get hard on. I have to struggle to get hard, but he's a guy who.
Well, you got
to
get on Deal a Meal.
Yeah,
that's why. You want a hard cock? You want some blood flow?
Give me an erection card.
Get on Deal a Meal. And then let's watch this other Slim Fast commercial now, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because this is another thing. I've tried Slim Fast. Yeah. It doesn't work.
No.
But this is when the great Tommy Lasorda.
Right, he was a baseball boy.
He was, yeah, and now he.
A year ago when I looked like.
Here we go.
Okay, let me get it.
One second.
This, you'd never catch me in a bathing suit, but that was before I lost 30 pounds in 3 months with Ultra Slim Fast. And I feel 10 years younger.
Well,
and with
shit.
Bathing suit season here, if you start the Ultra Slim Fast plan today, a healthy, delicious shake for breakfast, one for lunch, and then a sensible dinner.
Sensible
hey,
dinner.
You put on a bathing
bowl
suit,
of spaghetti.
You might look as good as I do.
Ultra Slim Fast. Give us a week. We'll take off the weight.
Wait, go back because I forget. There's a
there was a thing that said average weight loss 4 pounds.
4 pounds.
4 pounds. Average weight loss is 4 pounds on
it's
Slim Fast.
It's not even
which is
weight.
What happens. You yeah. do it for 3 days, you lose 4 pounds, and then you're like, I can't.
Because well, you're drinking milkshakes. You shit all out.
You're drinking chalky milkshakes that are kept in some fucking. You just can't.
A year ago.
That picture.
A year ago, I was a fat fuck. I couldn't get in a bathing suit.
I was shitting my pants
every day. Of course,
day.
It's an Italian meal. You know, he's like, but then I had the shake for breakfast, a shake for dinner, and the mama sauce.
Come get a dinner roll.
And then I lost all the weight.
Give us a week, we'll take off the weight.
Give us a week, we'll take off the weight. By the way, what does that even mean? Like, yeah. what? That was the 80s and 90s. By the way, that's cocaine, not yeah. slim. That's not a diet.
Yeah.
That's a cocaine addiction.
What was more honest?
Give us a week, we'll take off the weight.
What was more honest back then was they used to have just little amphetamines on, like, the, you can buy right. at the gas station.
Yeah. just take some, what would they call them? Like, blue, black beauties or yeah. whatever? Yeah, they would just shove amphetamines in your face. Right. Yeah. You just smoke ciggies and just fucking.
That's the way Americans lose weight. That's a natural.
It
way.
Is the way Americans lose weight is they lose weight with. But I'm you know, we're gonna commit. We gotta find one of these diets that'll work.
I say
it's tough out there.
Yeah,
we were almost not on time for this because we were at Cold Stone Creamery getting cakes for after the live stream.
Well, we went close. We had to go far, pretty far to get them.
Yeah,
we went to a closer Baskin Robbins, but it was being robbed.
Yeah, it was just a guy pacing around a Baskin Robbins,
and then three guys watching the cash register.
Yeah, imagine robbing a Baskin Robbins. Imagine him just being like
you're just smashing the guy's face with a bullet gun.
Yeah, it's just some poor Indian woman. It's like that scene from American History X. You're just bashing her head in a thing of sprinkles
for like 80 for 65 bucks.
Give me my goddamn money. Well, what are some of your favorite highlights of the year? I mean, it's been a crazy year, but people have, you know, figured out ways to thrive.
Well, look, it's a great year for getting to know your family.
Yes.
Whoever you happen to live with, your roommate.
Right.
It's not, look, if you don't know your roommate's entire history by now, you're just doing it
right.
wrong.
Right. Well, and also people made money. Let's get up the people that have made a lot of money. There's a lot of people that have made money. We have a list of people that have become billionaires. And this is very nice for people that are maybe depressed.
Yeah, look, something for aspirational for you to feel good about.
If you're depressed at you know, the government killing any chance you had at earning any type of living.
Look, the government didn't mishandle anything. I want to get that out of the way.
Listen, do you need to work? Yeah. What do you need to do, really?
Well, we had too many restaurants.
Yeah, too many restaurants. Yeah, I mean, we're all on a diet plan. Now, right. Now it's like, hey, we closed all the restaurants, just get Postmates, get Uber Eats, just sit on your couch and eat. And then there's just been a rash of strokes. Because people aren't moving and there's no blood flowing.
The stimulus plan should include deal a meal.
Yeah. You should get a deal a meal wallet.
Right. And it's like a can of Slim Fast.
Yeah. There you go. Good luck, everybody. Deal a meal. I mean, the stimulus so Mitch McConnell's holding it up. He's saying 2000 is socialism for rich people.
He's saying what?
$2,000
is socialism for rich people.
Correct. He's saying we're giving you $2,000 for rich people.
But that's what Mitch McConnell. There's 100 rich people have one of the money. What are you talking about? There's people, the children are starving.
Yeah, there's food lines that stretch for 5 miles in Texas.
Dude, like, it would cost less than $1 billion to give everyone $2,000. Like, that's one, like, drone plane.
Yeah, it's one unnecessary war somewhere. But cashing in on COVID, pandemic turns 50 doctors and scientists into billionaires with more than half hailing from China. Well played. Hey, China.
Look, I mean, it's a coincidence, but it's a well-positioned coincidence.
It's a well-positioned coincidence. The most notable new billionaires are Uğur Şahin, the physician who co-founded BioNTech, which helped develop the Pfizer vaccine.
Okay.
And Stéphane Bancel, the CEO of Massachusetts-based Moderna.
So these, I thought Pfizer was like already These are just like subsidiaries?
Well, these are competition. Moderna's, okay. Moderna has a vaccine. Pfizer has a vaccine. Okay. There's not like one vaccine.
I know that.
This is, but no, but it's hilarious, yeah. actually. Yeah. There's not like one doctor-approved vaccine. There's like a competition. It's like, there'll be commercials within 8 months where it's like, we think Pfizer's vaccine's a little, you know, come to Moderna.
What kind of cookie? Yeah. Cuck vaccine you taking?
Yeah. You're taking a Pfizer vaccine? I got Moderna. I got the Buffalo Wild Wings vaccine.
You're going to have like the vaccine, like the Pepsi challenge, the vaccine challenge.
Yeah, the vaccine
challenge. See if this paralyzes you.
Does this give you Bell's palsy? Report back to us. I mean, we're going to have just a bunch of vaccines from a bunch of different people, and everybody will be taking them, and a few of them will work. Some of them won't work.
The nice thing is you won't know who to sue when my wife dies.
Yeah, right. You have no idea. You'll just go to be like, you know what it'll be? You'll be searching through paperwork. Yes. You'll be going through papers. You'll be like, what vaccine did she even take? Did she take Moderna or Pfizer? No. We don't remember. She had that stroke, and you're going through paperwork. You're like, see, here it says Moderna. Who was the doctor that administered?
There's some disinterested woman on the line. Well, do you have the vaccine ID number or not?
Be like, I don't know. She got it in a car wash. She was vaccinated in a car wash.
It came free with the wash.
Yeah, it's free with the wash. We don't really know. Do you have that car wash receipt from 3 years ago? Your mother just died of a stroke. We don't know who to sue. Is it Pfizer?
Oh, God.
Other notable newcomers include Juan Lipping, whose net worth skyrocketed to $4.1 billion after
he sold fake masks, it looks like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Juan, who owns 24% of vaccine producer Shenzhen Kanghai Biological Products, became Canada's richest woman following their divorce.
What?
Hu Kun, who chairs China's Contact Medical Systems, also became a billionaire with a net worth of $3.9 billion. So this is all directly related to the pandemic.
Look, you might say it's fishy. I think it's just good old American capitalism.
Right. Co-founder of AbCellera, a biotech firm that uses artificial intelligence to identify antibody treatments for diseases.
Why do these companies all sound like other diseases? AbCellera. What is this?
Yeah.
Who makes this canteen? Lung cancer.
Right. Carl Hansen, the CEO of Leukemix. Leukemix is making the vaccine for, it's crazy how much they do sound like diseases.
This is half the game is just to beat down the people even more.
Right.
They I don't believe in the whole Bill Gates is trying to necessarily poison everyone. He is, but
he's trying to make money.
He's trying to make money. But, you know, the idea that, it's all a stock scam. Like everybody knows, everything's a stock scam in this country.
They just want to go to the market with good at like, hey guys, we got the juice.
You can't go. I mean, I guess you can't hold Harry's vaccines.
Right. Harry's vaccines. But Ben, you know for a fact that Bill Gates supposedly heard the podcast.
That's what I've heard. I've heard it's been shared with him and he watched it. Yeah.
And this is coming from somebody that's reputable.
Yes. Yeah.
And
reputable.
They said, what about Bill Gates? They said his brother.
What about his brother?
They said his brother or something like. What didn't his brother show him the podcast?
The brother showed him the podcast, and we know this because our friend is used to play music with someone who knows Bill Gates, who knows the brother, and showed Bill Gates the podcast.
I wonder what Bill Gates' reaction was to.
I'm worth $100 billion. So
I love that Bill Gates is. You can let the dog roam. It's okay. I love that Bill Gates. I love the idea of like that we're the only ones, or I'm the only one standing in his way. He's just so happy about that. He's like, oh, great.
I just wonder. It's like It's been a while since they had a success with like Microsoft. Like the phones were all shit. Windows.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, they need to get into they need something else.
This would be huge for them. This would be
big.
I mean, wouldn't it be amazing if Apple went the way?
You know, they got a little excited. Gates got a little excited. Him and Melinda got a little excited about this. Because by the way, even if you don't think they're evil people, their whole life is about this.
This is a long play.
This is the long play. Yeah. Their entire life has been about this.
Look, best case scenario. Like they everyone was like, why don't you like donate to other things and maybe in your cities? Like, no, we're going to Africa.
Yeah.
We're going to kill some kids and also save some kids.
Yeah. We're going to India. We're putting shit in the water. We're seeing what happens. Right. They just love diseases.
And also
they don't care about criminal justice reform. They don't care about the wars. They don't care about financial. They love disease. They just like pandemics.
I might shoot a missile at the sun.
Right. Let's block it. Let's shoot atmospheric dust. See what happens. Yeah. They want big. One thing about Gates is he really is the super villain. Dylan, like, he wants big plays.
Right.
He doesn't care about a young black kid that's gets caught up in, you know, smoking a joint, goes to jail for 6 years.
He's not LeBron James.
Yeah, Bill Gates doesn't care. Bill Gates wants, it's got to be a fucking apocalyptic vision to get him hard. To get blood to his dick, we got to be talking about apocalypse and vaccinating billions of people.
Can we bring back dinosaurs to cure COVID?
Right, right. Yeah, that's the next plan. He is like the guy from Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
You know, because probably during Jurassic Park, they're like, you could use so much of your science to do other things. And he was like, I want to see velociraptors on this fucking island. And if you get in the way of that, I'll kill you. But, you know, people, when is our other guest coming, by the way?
In about 25 minutes.
25 minutes.
Yeah,
should 20 we
minutes,
tell everyone who the no one knows who the other guest is?
It's Sally Struthers. She's gonna talk about her ab machine or whatever.
Sally Struthers surviving COVID. Yeah. To Sally, can you Google if Sally Struthers has COVID? Yeah. Is she even alive?
I hope so.
I mean, it's amazing. Lucy, do you mind the dog?
Yeah. She loves dogs.
Good. You know, it's a Sally Struthers is still around. You know who's my favorite? Who's a chick from SNL that's full QAnon? You know, she's great.
Who is that chick?
She's Victoria something. She's like full Kate Q.
McKinnon.
Yes, Kate McKinnon. Yeah, who's the chick? Pete Davidson. How great would it be if Pete Davidson went full QAnon? Why
dad,
not?
Look, my dad.
What do you think John Mulaney's doing in rehab right now?
He's probably doing heroin.
Yeah. He's probably doing heroin. I mean, I wish him the best. God love John Mulaney, and I hope that everything's okay. I met him once briefly.
He never helped me. You go ahead and thank
him. Never helped me either, but I don't want him to be in the depths of a cocaine addiction.
I'm kidding. I love the guy. I like the thing he was in.
Yeah. Victoria Jackson.
Yeah.
Victoria Jackson is great because she went full Q.
What, she did?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Q. Yeah. She went full Q.
I love how it's always zany ones. It's always like the...
Yeah, she went to Florida Bible College. She's a phenomenal woman, Victoria.
Is Flo from Progressive going to be a Q dropper?
Who are the break? Yeah, Flo from Progressive. She's a hardcore anti-vaxxer. Did you know that?
Who?
Flo.
Really?
No, I'm kidding.
Okay. That'd be great.
Flo from Progressive.
Hey, I'll tell you how to say 15%.
Dude, how soon is it until Tina 40 is Flo from Progressive? Like, how soon is it until companies start advertising his products with the insane people? Like, Tina's like, you better get a Mercury Mountaineer, motherfucker.
We also insure motorcycles, motherfucker.
Yeah. You like cars? You want to go fast, you faggot? How about this? Get a Mustang GT, pussy. Go over to Ralph's Used Autos.
I almost died.
I almost died of COVID. I don't give a shit. I was in the hospital for 2 weeks dying of COVID. I love the way she talked about it. She's like, yeah, so I was dying of COVID.
So anyway, I'm going to storm into a Ralph.
Yeah, I was dying of COVID. 2021's a year of I'm just doing flash mobs. They're going to run into Ralph's and pull people's masks off and spit on
punch
them.
Their baby.
Yeah. By the way, everything she's describing is wildly illegal. Yes. Like, not even just the mask. It's the idea if she's just going to mobilize 50 or 100 people and run into stores.
It's an act of terrorism.
Yeah, it is an act of terrorism. Well, she's a lot of fun. And all right, what do you think about these people that are, you know, complaining that they can't work and that the government is not giving them any help at all?
I mean, maybe you shouldn't have spent 20 years trying to build a business.
But here's the deal. I think these people can get rich if they are get smart about it. And we have some things here. Where they can 885,000 people filed for unemployment this week, but have any of those people thought about starting a business from their home?
Oh, I mean, what kind of bit? What would be a proper?
Well, I would like to get this guy up. This guy Daryl Davis, who used to do real estate seminars while he was coked out of his mind. He would sit in his car and wait for a cocaine dealer, and would then do cocaine in his car, and then he would give people really good advice about how to start a real estate empire.
I'd love to hear
I'd really like to hear about Daryl Davis. This is how to increase cash flow in real estate.
What's interesting is it's hard to, the idea. Like, how do you actually do it?
How do you do it?
Yeah.
Well, what's great about this guy is he's got a lot of specifics. He's got a lot of specifics. This is like Gary V. for people that have two DWIs and were dropped off to work by their mother. Right. So they don't have an actor's driver's license, but they want to conquer the world of real estate. And it's amazing. This guy, Daryl Davis, we used to sit there and stare at this guy, and we were so broke and had nothing and so desperate. And we waited for hours and hours for him to say one goddamn specific thing, just one fucking thing. This is how to create cash flow in real estate Here we go. Daryl Davis.
Every business, I don't care what business you're in, you need constant money coming in on a regular basis. Are you all with me on this? Yes? So watch this. In our business, the problem in our business, our money goes up and it goes what? Down. You probably have some friends, family, neighbors, whatever. Like, you have an idea how much money they make in a year.
He's so pale from the cocaine.
What you make?
That's the thing. He's so ghostly white because he does so much cocaine that he is just, he's a corpse.
Let's be literally. Let's be honest. You know how much your cocksucking neighbor makes? Yeah.
You see your neighbor, you see your neighbor pull up with a new BMW and you say to yourself, I'm sick of being a fucking nothing.
Bringing home more. But they seem to have more toys in the driveway, are going on more family vacations. Are you with me? What do they have? Cash flow. They got a paycheck every 2 weeks. If you took all their paychecks over the course of 12 months, if it's less than yours, they still seem to be able to have more because the money they have coming in is consistent. The problem in our business is the lack of consistency. And our attitude gets impacted by it at the same time.
That's right. Tell them, Daryl.
Let's say you were going to have 4 sales in 1 month. Let's say January, you had 4 sales. How would you feel?
Now, by the way, the fact that no one's answering when he goes, if you had 4 sales in 1 month, how would you feel? People are, the idea of having 4 sales in a month is so beyond their conception because they have nothing.
Well, isn't in your business, 4 sales wouldn't even be bad back then.
It would be great.
Yeah.
Now, the idea is he's gone, you have 4 sales, you feel pretty good, right? Everyone in this room is broke and they're staring at him like, I borrowed money to get here. I borrowed money to get here. My fucking wife keeps telling me, you're not a killer. You're not a closer. You need to get a regular job. Go work with your brother at Lowe's. There's an opening in patio. There's an opening in patio furniture. You got to do that. And he goes, no, 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 honey. You don't understand. Things are coming together. I got prospects.
Daryl comes in. You need to make more money. Not less.
Let's see what I'm staring at right now. Send me like 4. I can't even imagine 1. That's why my ass is here right now. If I had 4, I'd have no friggin' time to be in this room. If you had 4 sales in 1 month, you'd be like, yes, woohoo, I love real estate. Now, when this happened, what does a typical agent do when they have 4 sales? If they had a surge of cash,
they get a whore.
What do they do? Yeah. Come on, call it out. They spend it. They say, you know what? I deserve a break. Right, I've been working hard. I got money coming.
I'm going shopping.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Then now, next month, no sales. This is when we're suicidal. We're like, I can't stand this business.
Imagine, by the way, imagine like not having a clue, and then the fact that your company brought in this guy to help you figure out your life. Like,
let's
this
be honest. What happens when you make 4 sales a month? You go out, you get some bourbon, you fuck a few kids, all right? Then the cops come, they put you away. You got no sales next month.
You know what happens? You have 4 sales in a month. You decide to have a little fun with powdered cocaine, cook a little bit up, burn down part of the house, file an insurance claim, your wife's gone. You know, it's the 4 sales month. It's a big month. You know what happens. And then you don't make any sales the next month. Then you try to kill yourself. You end up in a youth hostel. I mean, this guy is so fucking tragic. Like, if you're sitting in that room staring at this guy going, this is the guy that has the answer? God, here we go. Let's play more of this.
Hate my broker. I'm changing companies. You know, because that'll always fix it. And then all of a sudden, they get a couple of relatives buy something. So they say, oh, I'm not changing companies. I love the team. I love the people I work with. Then next month, no money. Ah, I can't stand my spouse.
Is he drawing tits? What's he doing?
By the way, do you know real estate, we have the highest rate of divorce? We do. And I'm going to tell you why I think it is.
Because my dumb bitch wife won't listen to her. Right? Listen to me when I talk.
I love you. Don't touch me. We're bipolar.
My wife, you want a divorce? I'll fucking kill us both. That's how you leave me.
He's Like, he's clearly projecting. He's like, you know, real estate agents, we're all bipolar. We have a wife that hates us. Our kids won't speak to us. It's like, no, I don't know. This might just be you.
You know how it is when you walk into a broker's office, yeah. You shit your pants.
Yeah.
You start vomiting.
Yeah. You pull your dick out in front of someone. You're the bad guy. You know, real estate.
You told her she had nice tits. Yeah. So what?
Yeah. A cop pulls over. You say, fuck you, and spit on him. You end up in jail. You're a realtor. That's the way realtors behave.
Peaks and valleys.
Peaks and valleys. You grab your wife on the top of the stairs. You fall down the stairs. People get hurt because you're in real estate.
Accidents happen.
Accidents happen.
Some of us were on medication. I know. I saw some of you popping this morning. So how do we create cash flow in the real estate business?
Yes. How, Darren?
Well, listen. Let's look at other industries. Like, if you were going to get out of real estate and sell something else, what would you sell?
Everyone's answer in the room is pills, by the way.
Patient time.
Percocet.
Cars. Good. What else?
What a loser.
Solar panels. Yeah,
thank you, Mike.
Solar panels.
High-end pocketbooks.
I don't know. Some of the old people.
More people.
Alkaline water.
All right. What's that?
Chocolate with acai. Acai berry chocolate.
All right, William, thank you. Beauty products from the men. All right, anybody else? Insurance, listen, you can do it with any industry. It's the same concept, but somebody said shoes, a past student, thank you. Listen, you can-
Look at this, they're in a conference room. This is exactly where we used to be. This is exact, everybody in this room, let me tell you right now, is on the brink.
I don't think they need a study cam shot for this.
Yeah, right. Everybody in this room is on the brink because nobody that's making any money has to do this because they just go, I'm not going to the Darryl Davis thing. I'm making fucking money.
This guy in the middle is like, where did I spend my money?
Yeah. Your manager goes, you got to go to the Darryl Davis seminar. If you've got anything going on, you're like, I got a meeting. They go, all right, do that. Yeah. But all of these people they have no way to get out of this. So they're sitting in like the Melville Marriott or the Huntington Hilton or whatever. And they're just staring at this guy and they're hoping that they're going to figure out something to save their horrific lives.
Before the camera starts rolling, he's like, anyone holding?
Yeah. No, he does. He's a drug dude. One day, me and my boss walked outside. He was sitting in a Dodge Durango at 10:30 at night in the parking lot. And he gets out and he's got this Cheshire Cat grin. And he's clearly like all coked out. He looks at me and my boss. It's a Tuesday night. He goes, hey, where's the party at? And my boss goes, I'm going home to my kids, man. And I'm like, yeah, dude, I got an early meeting. And Dow goes, okay, maybe you got to close some more deals. And then he just got back in his car and sat there because he's clearly waiting for the white flower man to pull out and then hit him off with a few grams, give him an eight ball, and then he's just going to get coked out of his brain.
Yeah.
A guy like this, it's not a bad life. That's what people don't realize. If you could be a fake motivational speaker and get coked out every night and then just walk anywhere. Because here's the thing with these people in Long Island. They don't care what you say. Right. They don't really care what. Nothing has to make sense. You'll see in a minute. Nothing makes sense. And you could see them all. They're all kind of confused.
Yeah.
They've got papers in front of them. They don't know. He's in the crowd now. He's doing like some bootleg Tony Robbins. He's in the crowd.
What? Are those brochures like given to you by him?
Yeah, they're given to you by him. And it's just like facts and stuff. Garbage. It's like, you know, his whole thing is keep smiling.
Right.
Darryl Davis, keep smiling, which is easy to do if you're on cocaine.
Right.
So that's his whole thing. Darryl Davis, keep smiling. And watch. By the way, he said he started the video going, how to increase cash flow in real estate. He's not mentioned one specific thing about it. There's not one specific thing. How to increase cash flow in real estate. Let's see
Let me skip to that slide. You can go get watches. Now, I know some of you have heard this before, but we're highlighting it again for people who haven't heard it. If you heard it, you need to hear it again. Because like, all kidding aside, listen, if you wanted to sell shoes for a living, you got one of two ways to do it. You go get the store, you get the racks, you get the shoes, you advertise your shoe store. Hello, you put ads out. Internet, come to my store, buy my shoes. Yes. There's another
way to sell
shoes for a living. You want to sell shoes. You can go find a buyer who wants to buy a pair of shoes. Stick them in your car and then drive them from shoe store to shoe store to shoe store. Now tell me, which is the better business model? Driving the buyer to the shoe stores or having the store and having the buyers come to you? Which is better?
Neither one's a business model.
Store, right? Let me tell you something. I'm not telling you listings are the name of the game to list the last. I'm saying if you have no listings, you have an empty shoe store. As a matter of fact, every time you take a buyer out to show property, you're literally bringing him to another agent's shoe store.
All he's saying is do your job. He's like, yeah, if you have no listings, you're fucked. Right. We know that. We have no listings and we're fucked.
This is the same thing. We know that. So you want to be a doctor? Yeah. Well, you can't have patients call you if you don't have a phone.
Right. Yeah, that's literally exactly what it is. Everybody in there is like, yeah, we know we're fucked. We're here for help. And you're just restating that we're fucked 9 different ways.
You got to win, not lose.
Yeah. This is like, if you had a shoe store, you'd have shoes there and you'd sell them.
Now,
right?
Now, would you take them to get a hot dog?
Yeah. And the people in there, they're sitting in the room. They're like, no, no, no. If I had a shoe store, I wouldn't sell the shoes because I don't know what I'm doing. I need help. I need help. Can you help me? And there's no help given at all from this guy. And people leave confused. Like we used to go out. We'd smoke cigarettes after it. After his whole thing, we'd go. We go, what was that? And we go, and my boss would get mad because they get so invested in it and they paid him to be there. So my boss would be like, there's a lot of information there. Right. Take what you use. Take what you can use.
Would there be anyone, because some of these people are real idiots, right?
Yeah.
Was anyone like inspired by him?
Yes, to do nothing though. So people would be inspired by him and then go get drunk. Like they'd be inspired to just go get drunk and be like, we're gonna do it. We're gonna fucking do it. No excuses. Like I remember,
we're gonna do it.
Like my boss, they would go out and they would get a rip roaring hammer and he'd be like, no excuses. And then the next day, everybody wakes up with a headache. Like, what were we doing?
He fucked us. Yeah, fucked us.
He used to have a mantra and he would say, before you get on the phone with a client, you would do 3 things. I want you to focus. I want you to take baby steps. Don't, you know, blow the load, but take baby steps. And then before you make any sales call, say, knowing what I know now, okay? Knowing what I know now, what have I learned before I make this sales call? So literally there'd be guys walking around the office going like, focus, focus, baby steps, baby stepping. And before they picked up the phone, they'd go, knowing what I know now. And then they'd be like, hello, Mrs. Miller. This is Chris from Continental Home Loans. And then she would hang up. She'd be like, you'd hear like, the fuck up, click. And then he'd be like, crack his knuckles and he'd be like, all right, knowing what I know now. And then he'd pick up the phone again. It was just, you know, I don't know how he gets this gig because I would love to do this. Like, how do you even get that gig?
Well, doesn't he just like wander around and like, I mean, originally there's people who do this on a higher level. But he just kind of shows up and like, I'll give me a grand and we'll fucking.
Yeah, no, he's the bargain basement Gary Vee.
Yeah.
He's the bargain basement Tony Robbins. This guy haunts Long Island losers, like right. He's coming around. If you're in an office where no one's making money, Daryl Davis will find you. He will sniff you out and you will go to a hotel conference room. And by the way, this was filmed because it's a kind of a nice hotel.
Yeah.
He does this for like 10 people who are eating like lobby waffles.
At a Quiznos.
Yeah. He'll go into a Subway and start screaming at 9 people.
You're going to order an Italian sub and not have pepperoni?
Yeah. You don't know what the fuck you're doing.
He looks he actually looks like an embalmed corpse.
He's a corpse because it's just drugs. Like, and by the way, the first time we saw him, they go, this guy is one of the only motivational speakers who's performed at Caroline's Comedy Club. So immediately you're like, what the fuck is this? You're like, man, this is our life here. Like, and they go, so then he would do bits. Like he'd try to do jokes. He'd get on and he'd go, he'd be like, you know, I bought my treadmill. You know, the problem was I kept spilling my Tom Collins and there was nowhere to ash. And then everybody would like, it wouldn't land. And he'd go, okay. Like there's this guy, Rob Sivadonis, who's a comic from Long Island. He was an ex-addict who would do a bit when he first got on stage where he would take a bunch of mozzarella sticks and he'd be like, I'm glad I've gotten all my addictions under control. And the bit was he would just be stuffing mozzarella sticks into his throat while he said he was free of all his addictions. Because the bit is like, the audience goes, no, haha, you're a fat fuck. The bit would 9 times out of 10 bomb. And then he would have to take a wad of congealed cheese out of his mouth. And you'd watch him. Like, he'd be like, I'm glad I got all my addictions under control. And everybody would be like, what? And then he'd go. And he'd pull it out of his mouth. And he'd have to put it back. And then he'd like put it on like the speaker. And then he'd have to go like this. He'd be like, so I live with my mother. And then you'd have to go into that. So it's just like this guy would get up and bomb and then go into like, you know, his shoe store bit.
I mean, saying he's like the only guy who worked at Caroline's is like saying this is the only motivational speaker who's been convicted of aggravated assault.
Yeah. This guy is the only motivational speaker who's been convicted of petty theft, not grand larceny. So this dude, this is what people should get into. Get into that. If you're mad at the government for not giving you money, is the dog trying to fuck you?
No, it's just playing with my hat. It's fine.
Oh, all right. Just let him be. Right. Let Duncan be. Let the bulldog be. Our guest is coming up soon.
Soon.
How long?
In about 7 minutes.
Yeah. All right, let's prepare for our guest. This is very exciting to have this guest on. I'm going to tell everyone who it is. It's close enough. It is comedian, fighter, Brendan Schaub. And he's coming on the show, and we're very excited. I'm, of course, joking. But I will be guest hosting King of the Sting next week, if anyone cares. Are you excited about our guest?
I'm thrilled. I mean,
what do you think about our guest? Don't reveal our guest.
I used to listen to this guest.
Yes.
When I used to work in the graveyard shift at the Martin's Potato Bread Factory.
That is, I believe, his demo.
Yeah.
if 3 a.m. you're staring at potato bread alone in a warehouse, you're listening to this guest.
Yeah. And he got me through some rough times. He
was the bridge from rough times to rougher times.
Sure. Look, the financial crisis.
What happened after the potato bread warehouse? Didn't you go work in a morgue?
Yeah, that was fun. I enjoyed that.
He got me through some rough times. He said to me, "You're better than bread."
But I used to you know,
went from working in a place with no people
right.
to dead people.
Yes.
Have you ever worked in a place with alive people? Oh, yes, the jail.
Right.
So you've never actually worked at a place with alive people who weren't in confined.
The wedding photography, but that was about it.
Right. Wedding photography in Long Island is, I don't know how, you know. So that's amazing. You went from potato bread warehouse, just no people.
Right.
To dead people.
Yeah.
To confined people in a prison.
Yes.
Wow.
I mean, I was for mosquito lab.
Oh, but there are no people.
Right.
Really.
I would just be picking mosquitoes and moving them and whatever. But the point, no, but look. I was forced to work in the prison. It wasn't a choice.
Right.
The
county does what they want to do.
Yeah, they had their way with me.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
But no, but he would inspire me. He would motivate me as I was like, you know, you're stacking bread, you're getting sweaty, it's cold, and like, but you're still sweaty because you're moving. And I'm just listening to this guy. And he's just, I mean, you remember what it was like after 08 and 09? The economy collapsed. We're all looking for an answer. Just like that. We're all looking for an answer.
We all wanted something, and some of us found Daryl Davis, some of us found cocaine, some of us started doing stand-up comedy, some of us found this gentleman. I used to listen to this guy, this guest, in like the late 90s, early 2000s, right after 9/11.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's when I kind of got into him, and it was like fucking wild.
Sure. I mean, that was that was the end of innocence for America. I mean, it shouldn't have been, but, you know, that's when, you know, we realized that we could get hurt. And you, you know, and it was nice to have him as a cradle, kind of holding you.
Yes, he was a cradle,
smothering you into his bosom.
I mean, he did a lot of interesting work directly after the 9/11 attacks.
Right. Look, you can't look. Everyone now agrees it was fishy, except for like, you know, 10 senators and the.
Yeah, most people think something's up.
Just like Kennedy assassination.
Yeah,
the guy was ahead of his
time. Is he ready? Is he there? Yes. Okay. I can't hear him. I see him. We're getting volume. We're going to work on this.
One second.
We're going to work on this, sir. Don't worry. Can you hear me? You can hear me.
I can hear you, Andrew.
Yes. Well, now I can hear you. Alex Jones, welcome to the broadcast. Happy New Year.
Absolutely. In just a few minutes, we're going to be in the Atlantic Ocean right now. It's already the New Year in an hour. In New York, it's been the new year. In 2 hours here in Austin, it'll be the new year. So it's good to be here with you, Tim.
No, it's great to be here with you. And what are you doing for the new year? Are you broadcasting? Are you doing anything fun? It's a different new year. It's weird.
Our globalist mayor, it's just like in New York or New Jersey or any other leftist controlled area, like California with Governor Newsom. He's been caught flying around on private jets to the Caribbean where he meets with hundreds of people and doesn't wear a mask. It doesn't social distance. And he's been caught in the W Hotel where he lives, the mayor, not social distancing, having huge parties. But he declared martial law and said no one's allowed outside at night. The governor said he's not allowed to do it. It violates state law, but he doesn't care. So we're going to go to his house, the W, as soon as I'm do this great interview with you.
Yeah.
We're going to bullhorn the horrible little demon mayor we have and just expose him at a protest on First Street in Austin, Texas, downtown.
Well, that's great. And you get in a tank. You have like a tank. You have like a vehicle. And
about a year and a half ago, we bought an armored vehicle because Antifa started attacking other people's vehicles. So we knew riots were coming. We knew that BLM and Antifa were going to be turning up the heat. So we got the armored vehicle, and the people made fun of it, said you'll never be attacked. But they've thrown burning objects at it. They've beaten it with hammers. They've thrown signs at it. They've shot ball bearings at it. They had to replace some of the armored windows when they get cracked. They didn't make it into the armored part, but they cracked the outside window. And so if you guys are welcome to play, you can type in Alex Jones's tank gets attacked in Austin.
Who operates the turret while you're driving? Do you have a turret on the thing?
Well, we call it a tank, but it's an armored vehicle, a Gurkha.
Okay.
Stand like 50 caliber rounds and, you know, hand grenades and things. It's what they use in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's got a turret on the top, but not a gun. You can mount a gun. So, yes, I pop up out of the turret with a big loudspeaker system, kind of like Humongous Road Warrior. And I say, just, we spare your lives. Just give us the gas.
Yeah. No more fighting. I mean, it's a great visual. I saw you. You were down there because they were not letting people swim in a creek or something or a pool. Remember that? This was
Newsom has closed the beaches in California, like outside the sun's a safe place to be. Austin has the biggest green belts. It's not a state park, it's not a national park. Austin, back in the early 90s, took about 200,000 acres from people. And so about a third of the city is this big, giant green belt. It's as big as a state park or national park. And so now they put up fences at the entrances. There's hundreds of entrances and put lifeguards there. They closed all the pools. But put lifeguards at the edge of the forest saying, we'll arrest you if you enter the forest to save you from the COVID. But really, it's all just a giant control freak orgy of power grabbing.
It seems crazy. Now, I know that you speak to a lot of people in the White House or you're in that orbit. What is their feeling right now about what's going on? Do you think Trump will go to the inauguration? Will there be an inauguration? Is there any shot that this is a prolonged thing? I mean, what are you hearing and what do you think?
Well, according to YouTube, Google, Facebook, Twitter, and everything, I'm not even allowed to tell you about Senate hearings at the U.S. Capitol. That's been censored. They say that's not allowed. YouTube doesn't allow senators to talk. They actually censor opening statements. And I can't tell you what's happening in the Georgia House. I can't tell you what's happening at the Nevada or the Arizona State House or the Pennsylvania State House or the Michigan or Wisconsin. So I really don't want to get censored. So I can't tell you the massive findings that have been found, all the witnesses, all the videos, everything that was discovered, because we're in a free country. So I cannot tell you. You can look it up. U.S. Senate hearings are censored. I agree with Google and Facebook. You're not allowed to see. I'm just not going to tell you what's happening.
By the way, we're not on YouTube. We're on a private thing that people have bought tickets to. So you can say whatever you want. You are not on YouTube. You are not on Google.
Yeah, I know that, but let me be honest with you. I was being sarcastic. I was serious about everything I just said.
I know. Yeah.
Now, notice if you put info out, no one cares. We have hearings in the U.S. Senate the last 2 weeks where they show top scientists, MIT, Stanford, the witnesses, the 20 boxes of affidavits, all the computer programs, video of them flipping votes in live time, video in Georgia of they close the doors, say a water main broke. We're looking back and forth. They pull out black suitcases and start running the same piles through for hours, and then Biden skyrockets. And we've got the same footage everywhere. Total, complete fraud. Absolutely stolen election.
Why is the Republican not more, if because a lot of people are going to say, hey, if that's the case, why are the Republicans not, why are they calling Biden and congratulating him? Why are they not more aggressive?
Absolutely. That's a great point. Mitch McConnell's wife is on the Chi-Com, Communist Chinese payroll. They always hated Trump. The average Republican leader, I hate the Republican Party. I protested probably 500 times. We had a populist rebellion to get Trump in. He's not perfect either, but at least he was the president. He was trying to cut better deals. That's why they came after him. And so this is an orgy of election fraud. Remember, they said, we're going to have a red mirage, but then after that night, he will win because the extra ballots will come in. Well, those five states never had their legislatures pass laws to accept these 80 million fake ballots that weren't absentee ballots. And so that's why the Supreme Court should have overturned it. because it was never made in law.
It's a little odd that if it wasn't the way Giuliani has been operating around the country since the election, you have to admit it's a little wacky.
It feels very clumsy. I don't think Giuliani's helped anybody. It feels a little clumsy. Like he's out there and he's doing press conferences in the back of, gardening places. It feels strange. Like it feels
they thought the press conference was at the Four Seasons. Right. Four Seasons gardening.
He brings a drunk woman to Congress or whatever it was.
It seems odd. Like I feel like Trump does.
I'll tell you, Tim. That's what this is. This is ragtag like 1776. I agree.
Yeah.
Giuliani, is out there, all this stuff. But I've been actually following the real evidence that's come out, and it's been absolutely overwhelming. That was total fraud. So at 20 days out, about to be 19 days as we enter 20. You know, Tim, I'm never talking to you again until 2021. Grow up like 20. The year 2000 was way out there. Now it's the year 2021.
Crazy.
And instead, the year 2021, they're trying to give us an mRNA vaccine that reprograms our cells and has jellyfish DNA and human clone DNA in it.
Will I be able to swim better with it?
Yeah. Will we have any benefits from the vaccine?
Jellyfish is a colony creature.
Okay.
And its DNA is so ancient and so weird that in a genetic spectrometer analysis, it pops up. So they're actually going to lace everyone with a genetic marker with this jellyfish DNA. You know, a jellyfish isn't one creature with one mommy and one daddy. It's a colony creature.
Right.
They all come together and build that thing that goes around eating little fishies.
So you're not taking this vaccine.
Well, again, a classic vaccine would give you a dead bacteria or an attenuated virus that had been microwaved or radiated or damaged so that it wasn't active, it wasn't spreading, your body would learn how to beat it. George Carlin said, you need germs, learn how to beat them. That's not what this is. The old days, it's 500 years old inoculation. It came from smallpox. They learned that if somebody got smallpox in the summer, they hardly ever died. They learned that once you got smallpox, you didn't get it again. So they said, well, let's puncture the pustules on cows with a toothpick and in the summer, and let's stick it in somebody's side of their arm.
Right.
That's over 500 years old. That's a real technology. And the doctors would tell you back then, well, they were called barbers. Barbers didn't just cut your hair. They pulled your teeth out. They did inoculations. It started in France and England. They would stick the toothpick in you. You'd get a pustule on the side of your arm, just like the vaccine. And then you wouldn't get sick again. Instead of when you're run down in the winter and not getting enough food, not enough vitamin D3, then you get smallpox. It could kill you, 1% of the time or so. And so inoculation is a real technology. I'm not against technology. Hell, I love technology. It's that what they call inoculation now is just something being injected into your body. And so they have, quote, behavioral modification vaccines. Look these up. That, quote, cure you of drug addiction, cure you of cigarettes or cocaine or heroin. The problem is it literally is a live virus that either goes in and eats parts of your brain, certain receptors, because it recognizes those chemicals, or it creates protein blockers. So your brain creates plaques and can't absorb those chemicals. So yeah, that time you first scored, that date you wanted, or that time you got that big contract, or that time you saw that beautiful sunset, or that time, you finished that painting, or you finished remodeling your house or whatever it was that big accomplishment, that's associated with super high feelings of endorphins and a natural high. That's what cocaine and heroin and cigarettes and alcohol plugs into. But to knock out those receptors, you've got to knock out those higher moments in your life. And so that's why they have, quote, behavioral vaccines that aren't vaccine.
Dopamine, they're literal
lobotomies.
So how much cocaine is in the vaccine?
Right.
Is there cocaine?
People always think I'm on cocaine. Right. I have to take suppressants. Like I drink way too much. I'm not drinking right now. Right. I actually quit drinking the last week to lose weight. But I'm so high off life. I'm so manic that I drink alcohol to calm it down. People's like, that Jones must be on cocaine and heroin. No, I'm high on life.
Right.
And, that's a beautiful thing. Sorry, Tim.
No, it's a beautiful thing to be high on life. I mean,
you look great, by the way.
You look better. You look like you're heading in the right direction.
Well, you guys look great too. Let's all get in a big vat of baby oil together.
I'd love that.
So let me ask you a question. You have a lot of companies, Pfizer, Moderna, all these people, they stand to make lots of money. You know, and you have people like, you know, Bill Gates and stuff like that who, you know, a lot of the motivations for this are financial, and which is not always bad, right? We live in a capitalist system. People want to make money, and we get a lot of great innovations from capitalism. That's how, and a lot of problems, but some great innovations from capitalism. What goes off? What are your red flags that go off? Now, you explained that brilliantly about this vaccine being different from other vaccines, but let's, apart from the science of it, just the cultural implications of it, what makes you hesitant about everything that's kind of been going on, and what gives you pause?
Well, here's the thing. You said free market, and I believe in capitalism. It's not perfect, but compared to communism or fascism or socialism, it's been proven to be the superior system. It's still got its excesses, its laissez-faire problems. There has to be a balance. But going back to Ronald Reagan, who was overall, I think, meant well, but did a lot of really bad things. Ronald Reagan in 1986 signed the Vaccine Damage Act, and they put $2 billion in. It's like $10 billion now they've paid out to families of people that are damaged. So anything calling itself, whether it's gene therapy, whether it's antibody therapy, anybody doing that now gets liability protection for their products. Well, you've seen FinFin make you have heart attacks, and you've seen that other thing they gave women that made the kids have little shrunken arms and legs. You know, there's been all sorts of side effects. And when a drug gets approved wrongly and there's side effects, they stop the drug and they have to pay restitution. Well, that's not the case with vaccines since 1986. Now they've gotten other countries to pass liability protection. So you have an industry that's profit-driven, that has a history of contamination, a history of problems, saying, we're going to make you take this to have a job, get on a plane, a digital passport that tracks your medical records now or in some cloud with corporations. And we're not just going to bully you into this, but we're going to have liability protection while we do it. So that's the red flags for me. And they've got polls out there, upwards of 80% of medical workers don't want to take the vaccine. Well, then Pfizer, Moderna, and others have looked this up, came out a month ago and said, this actually won't protect you from COVID, and it won't even stop the spread of COVID, as a little proviso. The head of the WHO vaccine program on Monday came out, looked this up. Head WHO scientist says, not sure vaccine will stop COVID, will stop spread of COVID, or works. That's because here's the deal. They've never had a vaccine for the common cold. The coronavirus is the common cold virus. Now, it was souped up in a lab in Wuhan. They added a bunch of weird stuff to it. I know what's going on with that. That's so it spreads. Everybody gets it. But here's the thing. You were talking about motivational speakers. If a motivational speaker actually gives you the answer to things, then they're going to fix the problems and don't need to come back over and over again. Like, I'm a motivational speaker that actually has the answer to things. I actually know how stuff works. I know the globalists are and other operations. Here's an example. The CDC's own website, NIH's own website, National Institutes of Health, says, go NIH.gov and type in essential nutrients. And it'll give 13 vitamins and minerals that if you don't have them, you'll die within 6 months. Just like oxygen, you die in 5 minutes. Water, you die in a couple of weeks. Food, you die in a month or so. And it says vitamin D3 and zinc and C are essential, meaning if you don't have them, you'll die because any virus can replicate in your mitochondrial DNA. And this is off the NIH. Well, you're not a doctor. It's on the NIH website. So I made a big deal about this. And finally, Fauci got asked about it and said, well, yes, you do need vitamin D3. If you don't have it, you can die. So if you have high D3 and your body's absorbing it, and 43% of America in tests doesn't have enough D3. If you have enough D3, if you have C, if you have zinc, that affects cellular reproduction, mitochondrial operation. And so you want self-help. If you have those, you basically can't die of a virus. Then it goes into bacteria. It's very similar, but still, if bacteria get under a toe or, you know, you eat some bad food, they get a spot in your guts, even if you have enough vitamins and minerals, it can still eat a hole in your ass. Bacteria is a little different, but you're bulletproof if you have those three essential vitamins.
Isn't Fauci really saying, like, hey, you need water, you die if you don't have water, so if you want to live from COVID, drink water. It's kind of like you need D3, but then there's this, you're not necessarily saying it kills the virus.
No. See, that's the whole UN spin. Notice how we say, according to the World Health Organization, the UN, I mean, that's like above God. It's total law. According to them, there is no treatment or cure for COVID-19. What the hell does that mean? It means there's no hope until a vaccine comes out. They told us 11 months ago. Now the vaccine's out, they go, actually, it doesn't even protect you. And you have to stay locked up forever. Sorry, you got to track everything you do at 5 vaccines a year. No, it is clear. If you go to the NIH website, plus any nutritionist knows this. Here's an example. If you take, and they've lowered the allotment of what the FDA says you need really a lot more than what they say, studies show. But remember a thing called scurvy.
Sure.
Why do you think they call British limeys? Why do they call British limeys?
Because of the limes. They eat the limes to get rid of scurvy.
Exactly. The British, about 400 years ago, were the most advanced science. They had contests to create a clock, like the equivalent of like a $3 billion prize with today's money. And so they figured out that if they ate leafy vegetables or limes, it had something in it where their soldiers wouldn't get sick and weak when they were 6 months out on a ship. And before that, they knew about green peas. I mean, they eat dried green peas and, you know, hardtack. It's like basically dried, hard bread. And so they learned, and everybody made fun of them. The Spanish made fun of them. The Dutch made fun of them. The Japanese made fun of them. Everyone called them limeys because they put little key limes in their grog, which was two parts water, one part rum, because the sailors across the world thought water was bad. They thought drinking it was bad. Because back then, people were defecating in the rivers and stuff. They were right. They thought liquor was the safest thing. So they would mix the water with the grog, and they would put limes there. They actually just throw the limes in, so it's all just in there rotting together. And when the British would show up 2,000 miles from home, they would just kill everybody. Everybody was scared of the Brits because they would just dominate everyone because no one was sick. Because within a few months without vitamin C, your teeth fall out, all your old wounds open, blood starts coming out your ass. And so there you go. It's essential. And so if you have it, viruses cannot replicate in your cells, whether they're Ebola, whether they're COVID-19, doesn't matter what they are. They cannot replicate unless you are deficient.
Lime cure COVID is what you're saying.
Well, can we cure COVID with limes?
Well, let's expand on that. Once you're already run down enough to have a full-blown COVID case or any other pneumonia or any other flu, you're going to die because you're already run down. But they found that if somebody gets to the hospital, they've got major studies on this, it's an autoimmune response in most people that has their lungs swelling up like the 1917 Spanish flu. So if you give someone this aerosolized, there's a bunch of steroids that you inhale. Right. Within minutes, most people can be discharged within hours. They're having instant success. But the UN says, put a air pressure ventilator down you, and they pay the hospitals $53,000 to do that. So they're grabbing innocent, well, homeless people off the streets. This has just come out in the news. And they're going in key hospitals, same ones that harvest babies, and running hoses down their throats, turning it up and killing them to get that cash. And if you kill somebody, The Hill reports you get $300,000.
Where does this virus come from, in your estimation? Where does it come from? Yeah,
we know where it comes from. And Tim, you can look this up. And so can your wonderful consort.
Thank you.
Now, let me tell you. Don't believe me. Type in Fauci funded controversial coronavirus studies at Wuhan. You will get Newsweek this year. But you will get 5 years ago, New Scientist and other publications. It was a major controversy. Fauci's been at the NIH and headed it up, and the CDC in a rotating door for 46 years. He's a Bill Gates' basically mentor. So the supervillain, this is like a supervillain's daddy. He went to that facility, and it got made illegal at Chapel Hill, North Carolina, 6 years ago in 2015. It got made illegal to do gain-of-function coronavirus research. Coronavirus gain-of-function means really spreads fast. Where they were chimera-ing it and mixing it with all these bat DNA and HIV sequences and P shuttle gene gain of function delivery systems. All this, I'm saying, you can write it down, look it up, you'll be blown away. So they moved it to China, that's the Wild Wild West, where you do anything you want, to Wuhan, and Bill Gates and Fauci ran 11 programs with coronaviruses there. And then magically, when Trump starts defeating his impeachment, boom, it's released. China does kabuki theater of locking everything down. There's all this fear. It comes here, and the rest is history. So it came out of Wuhan. It's a man-made regular coronavirus with HIV gain of function delivery system and a lot of other stuff wrapped into it. And then, but the really what's deadly is the vaccine response to it is these mRNA vaccines.
Do you think it's possible that it came from the lab, but from people selling? I've heard some speculation that people were like the employees were selling the animals to like the markets afterwards. Do you think that's?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, look. I've had Dr. Francis Boyle, who authored the U.S. Biological Weapons Treaty and the World Government, you know, UN Treaty. And he said back in February on my show, you can look these up, you can have him on your show. He's a big professor. He said that he thought it was released on accident because it's a war crime to release it on purpose. But I think they did it on purpose. I mean, because they're like, oh, all the media, oh, we don't know where it came from, a bat cave. Oh, it came from, oh, now they call it the European virus. Oh, it came from Europe. No, ladies and gentlemen, it was a program at Chapel Hill, coronavirus, gain of function research, look it up, mainstream news 6 years ago. And it was done there and then it was released. The Gates Foundation calls it the Great Reset. And the Gates Foundation calls it Operation Lockstep. And they said,
what do they mean by that? The Great Reset. What does that mean? Because I've heard that a bunch.
That's Klaus Schwab, the head of the UN Sustainability Group, which means depopulation group. He heads up the Davos Group. And he said, you will own nothing. You will have nothing. You're going to like it. We're going to use this to implode the capitalist economy and end capitalism and bring in an equitable system where everyone's given a universal income of $1,200 a month. But you're a slave, and you have to take all the inoculations, and everything you do is tracked and controlled. And so it is a giant fascist corporate takeover for big tech. And all these companies have made 30, 40, 50%. Some of them have doubled profits. They're essential. We're not essential. It's basically Adolf Hitler 2.0.
But if it is a bioweapon, just because I'm not ruling that out, but don't you... Certain countries have been able to handle this a lot more effectively than us. So don't you think as a bioweapon itself, it seems like you have to rely on the fact that like we'll kind of just not take any precautions and not like, you know, the people won't be reasonable. Well, the way we've kind of had no policy and no real, I admit we have like a zero effective policy in this country, but it's kind of a weird weapon. You're kind of banking on that.
Alex, that's my co-host. He's a fat communist. I'm kidding, but he is fat. So anytime someone disagrees with you, Alex, it's not me. It's my co-host. I don't know if you can see him. He's to my left.
Hey, no, I see him. He is a luscious man. I love you. I heard about you in the friend shop.
Oh, yeah. Okay, great. Yeah.
And I'm not making fun of you because you're luscious. So am I. Show me your belly and I'll show you mine.
Oh, we'll do that in private.
Yeah. So, but you see.
No. Show the belly. Show the
belly. It's bigger than yours.
Belly, okay.
So now. Alex, right. You look good. You look fine. So the media doesn't care about this. The media is not looking. What did you say?
Did you disarm me now, Tim?
Not yet, but we'll see. If depends how many views we get. But I'll tell you this. The media doesn't care.
You know, we've been dating for 5 years and stop lying about it being ashamed of our relationship.
I'm not ashamed. I'm moving to. I got to move to Austin. Get rid of the state tax. Got to move me in.
We're getting married. Yeah, we got a house together. That is we're going to Juan the Love Tunnel art. Let us stop. That's called a joke, folks. Let's get serious. Yeah. Actually, dating his boyfriend right there. Hey, let me go back and answer his question. I'm gonna stop right there and let you go next.
Yes,
brother, you're just regurgitating the talking points. What was the point you were saying? I forgot what it is. Day one, they go, oh, China was shooting women at checkpoints and welding people in their houses and running around. And, oh, they get COVID and they fall down and then flop around the ground. Turned out that was all fake, all theater. And China on national TV brags, we hit them with COVID. They'll never reopen. They're cowards. We control Biden. Even Tucker Carlson airs these videos. And so it's the PCR test. The inventor said's a fraud. 96% of it's false positives. And so let me tell you what's happening. 96% is false positive. Remember, 5% were going to die, then 4%, then 3%, then 2%. Now it's not 99.999. It's 0.0000 something out there at the side. Notice there's no flu deaths last year. It's all COVID deaths. Notice CDC numbers are almost complete. we're going to lose about the same number in 2020 as we lost in 2019. They cannot hide from these numbers. Motorcycle accidents, skydiving accidents, boating accidents, cancer.
Right,
all the congressman-elect that just died. He had a freaking heart attack. The Jeffrey Epstein cellmate was found dead in his house. They said it was COVID. Holy shit. If I get run over by a fucking truck tonight, it's going to be COVID. It's fucking bullshit. It's Chicken Little, economic witch hunt warfare to lock us down so we never leave our fucking houses again.
When are they going to, when do you think it's going to, when do you think people are going to realize that something's wrong? I don't know what's wrong, but something is wrong. Something's wrong. People are starting to figure it out. People are now, whether it, they're starting
to California, the woman's little restaurant's been closed for months, but right next to it, the chain restaurant's open.
Right.
They're saying we're not essential. They're shutting down the local economies. It's war. It's fraud. If they catch every politician, every major Democrat governor, they catch Republican governors that are part of it. They caught the main ministers in Canada. They're all flying around on jets at parties. They're all with hookers. They're all doing whatever they want. They're not wearing masks. It's a freaking scam, folks. When you get on private jets, you ain't wearing masks. When you go to four-star hotels, you ain't wearing masks. When all the elites walk around Dianne Feinstein, she ain't wearing a mask. It's a symbol of fear, like the burqa and Islam and Sharia law, and it's fucking bullshit.
But I agree with you in a lot of aspects here. But I mean, they did 9/11, they did the Iraq War, like, and the people really didn't fight back. So it's like it doesn't seem like they need us to comply that much more. You know what I mean? Like, we don't.
All different globalist power factions. Let me explain how this works. Let me tell you, there's not one group, okay? They're all bidding for power over the surveillance grid and over the genetic engineering. And all the old men want to test on the public with mRNA. This is really to create mutant humans and mutant tests, because they know if they test on billions of people, they're going to find what they call the Lazarus gene, or what they call the immortal gene line. There was a black lady, look it up, immortal gene line, forget her name, in the 1950s.
I think her name was immortal.
I'm not joking. This is real. Okay, it's a black woman in the 50s, and they've only found like 10 other people that have it. Last time they released a number, I'm sure it's more now. That's what all the DNA testing and send this in 23andMe, and you learn they secretly are gathering it.
Yes. Henrietta Lacks.
These are cells. This black lady died in a week of cancer. Like
Henrietta Lacks is her name.
Sorry, go ahead. What?
Henrietta Lacks is her name. We just looked it up.
Okay, good. She died. Well, I'm going for her. What? 1950? What?
1920 to 1951 is when she died.
1920 to 1951. Yeah.
So they're saying ate her in a week. Now listen. They've put the cells, because the doctors are like, "What is this? Killed her?" Like, it like ate half of her in a week. It was like a blob. Wasn't flesh eating bacteria. It was freaking. They're like, so they put it in a petri dish. 50, 60 years later, dude, the freaking cells don't die. You can cut oxygen off. You can freeze it. They're still alive. But only thing kills them is fire. So vampires aren't real, but this woman's real. Now, they are looking for the immortal cell line, the Lazarus gene. And that's what the MRA is trying to program and trying to find. They've got some super advanced ancient technology. It's probably aliens. Aliens don't come from an ancient star system. They come from another dimension. And these aliens are giving people during DMT trips the knowledge on how to do all this, and they're the knowledge, they're building what the aliens are telling them to build, which is actually a system to destroy us. And the globalists already say we're building a post-human world, we're going to merge the machines soon, we've got to kill everybody first. Well, if you're going to be gods, become gods and then save us. Don't, I've got to kill you before I become God. I know this all sounds crazy. I'm not the one saying all this. So
does that
looking for the Lazarus gene.
The longest lance, is that part of this too? You know what I'm talking about from the Bible, with the spear that they put into yeah, Jesus.
Spear of destiny,
right?
Spear of destiny into Christ's side. Yeah, that's, you say you're invincible if you have a spear of destiny. That's something Hitler was obsessed with. But the point is that this is real. Okay, they found like 11 people last time I checked. They're being very secretive about it. Who the cells don't die, and they replicate forever. And the sequences don't have any errors. But normally when someone gets this, it eats them. So it's like some blob thing, like, oh, I've got a spot on my arm. A week later, it's eating your whole arm off. Okay.
And this is that it's a gene that 11 people have that makes their cells immune from death.
Yes.
I thought it killed them.
But it kills them. But their cells live. How does this work?
No, exactly. This alien thing takes them over. It lives forever.
It's the blob.
Okay, so it's like...
It's blob.
Yeah. And okay, so they are looking to figure out what this alien thing is.
And so they've taken the clone DNA of a kid that had this in 66, and that's reportedly in the Pfizer vaccine, and they're injecting an immortal cell line into people with the Pfizer vaccine as the intel.
And that cures COVID.
No, it's supposedly going to create some mass mutation, and who the hell knows what's about to happen. This is and here's the deal. They've gotten so many people to commit to this and say it's good that when the mass death starts, just like with autism, everyone's going to join it and cover it up and be part of it. Just like the vaccine's already killing people. It's already causing death. It's already causing epilepsy. It's already causing Guillain-Barre's. It's already causing, what's the one where your face gets paralyzed?
Bell's palsy.
Bell's palsy. I mean, it's on like Donkey Kong. And again, I'm going off what Wolfgang Wudarg, the head EU scientist on the advisory board, saying. I've interviewed him many years ago, speaking of 9/11, he's a truther, and the former chief scientist at Pfizer. December 1st, they did like a 30-something page document with links to hundreds of pages of studies. And they said, we don't know what you're doing, but we looked at this vaccine. And off what you did, you skipped the trials. It says it'll turn your immune system off. It'll turn your immune system up. You got the complete genetic code of a immortal cell line kid inside of you. And that died in 1966, this white kid. You've got all this going on and a jellyfish genome. This has nothing to do with COVID-19. What are you doing? That's why type in. Top virologist says, do not take shot. It will kill you. Top scientist says, this is the road to hell. They look at it and they go, is this the movie Alien 2.0? I mean, dude, I don't know what they're doing. It's bad, okay? It's over, all right? 1 million people have already took it in the U.S. I have no freaking idea. Listen, remember what I said 10 months ago? The headlines are everywhere. Type in Alex Jones. Even Howard Stern made fun of me and immortalized it. Alex Jones says there's HIV and COVID. Well, it says that when the Indian University and the Australian University scanned it, because Australia, the U.S., India, and others have CRISPR editing systems. They cost over $1 billion. These electron microscopes know how to read what's in the genes so they can actually look at it. And they went, oh, my God, this is man-made. Look at the insertion points. It's 5 viruses. It has the mRNA delivery system. It has the HIV delivery system. It doesn't give you HIV. It has the delivery system of it, which mainly targets brown people. And they totally freaked out about it. So I said, will people get HIV from this? The Australian vaccine was simply a radiated version of COVID-19, which would be a classic vaccine. You simply irradiate the virus so it doesn't actually replicate, but your body learns what it is. That makes sense. Might have a bad reaction. Still, it will probably work to teach you how to beat it. They're all testing positive for HIV because it's a goddamn HIV virus. And I said that 11 months ago, and I'm on record. I'm not a rocket scientist. I had scientists on saying, if they make a classic vaccine of this, you'll test positive for HIV.
So here's my question, because a lot of what you're saying makes sense. But then you have Trump go out and go, hey, we have a vaccine being delivered. It's safe. What's that about?
Oh, I mean, listen. Trump's a real president. He really got elected. The system doesn't like him. But he doesn't know a lot of stuff. I've sat there. People I know have talked to Trump. I tried to explain to him, sir, like 3 years ago, sir, section 230, they have immunity with the media. You've got to take it away. They're totally encircling you. Now, what is that? They're interesting. Somebody else is on the line. He doesn't know. They come to him and say, sir, we can reopen things if you just have a vaccine. He's like, great. He's thinking of vaccines he took. He's 75 years old, for God's sakes. A total mistake. Horrible what he did. It doesn't mean I'm on some, let me tell you something. I had a bunch of money in the bank before Trump got elected. I was on more radio stations. I was not being sued by the Democrats. Supporting Trump has been no bed of roses. And so I'm not on some Trump cult. He means well. He tried to stand up to China for us. He was in over his head, and it's a nightmare situation. But I you're absolutely right. Trump's biggest failure was pushing all this damn vaccine crap.
What about all these people that got sucked into QAnon? Are they going to have to admit that they got sucked into something that isn't necessarily wasn't true?
Well, here's the thing. Joe Rogan calls me about a year and a half ago and he goes, hey, I really like Tim Dillon. You ought to have him on the show. I said, oh, I've seen some of his stuff. I like him. I'll have him on. I talked over you and had like half a bottle of vodka before you got on. And just kind of like wanting to, you know, go eat enchiladas and just trying to get you out of here. And then, though, it made me start watching what you were doing. And now I'm a stalker and, you know, watch all your stuff and I love it. But the your QAnon breakdown, that's why I want to get you back in the studio for like 2-3 hours. You can actually talk. Was the very best you did on Joe Rogan like 6 months ago. I thought that was the best analysis. I don't want to be mean to these people, but like we wake them up and it's kind of like, you know, like your kid learns how to drive a car and suddenly he knows how to drive better than you do. It's like, oh, you know, dad, I don't need to hear about changing the oil. I'm a hot rodder now. I can drive 150 miles an hour. And they just believe everything's fine and trust the plan and everything's magic, because really knowing about politics is stressful to know the facts and to go through all the evidence, and still you make mistakes. And so, yeah, I've had people walk up to me in restaurants and go, you know what, I used to like you, but Q says you're bad. I mean, Q is literally a 4chan or 8chan board, and it's just a total scam. But it's like a religion, because you've got the weird breadcrumbs that people put out. It's like reading a pile of shit, people that see Virgin Mary and a piece of toast. Then you've got the Q lords, the Q priests, who then prophesy over all of it. And Hillary's in Guantanamo for 3 years and Bill Barr's arrested and all. And then meanwhile, I'm talking Trump's main lawyers. Because I had the same feds trying to indict him, trying to indict me. So I've got Trump's lawyers working for me. I mean, I'm not bragging. My God, it's like I'm in Hitler's bunker or something. Not like I'm doing a great job here. And I'm sitting there knowing that Trump's surrounded, like knowing what's going on inside the White House. I mean, you know, it's cool to have the president call you, but it's like, you know, it's like, yeah, I'm not comparing him to Hitler. It's in the example of Hitler's like calling up his generals before Berlin fell, going attack, attack from the West, attack with Steiner, attack with, there's no army there. And then I'm telling Q people, no, he's in trouble. Even before the election, they're going to steal it. They're like, oh, shut up. Everything's fine. And so to deal with that level of delusion has not been fun.
Now, when he leaves office, do you expect him to continue any type of political life, or do you think he will kind of fade away? What is the Trump brand post-presidency? As you know,
I think it's great that I think it's great that he has not conceded. I think he's a stalwart. There's absolute election fraud. He should be challenging. He's a great guy. He's a great American. In my view, he really cares. Just criticizing him, I criticize myself. I got trouble balancing my checkbook sometimes, even though I got plenty of money. So he needs to stay on his feet. He needs to fight. He needs to be the leader of the resistance, of the populist movement, just for the fact that we're about to have the Chi-Coms and the globalists take the country over, and they're going to try to put him in prison. They've got criminal investigations going on in the Southern District of New York and a bunch of other places trying to indict his whole family. They're trying to indict everybody in the circle. They're trying to indict me. And so for literally nothing. And so I'm not going to get any details. So, folks, this is one hell of a fight. So I'll criticize Trump because he's just a man. But compared to China Joe and China Mitch McConnell, that totally, I mean, you know, Trump's like, hey, if you're going to give hundreds of billions to foreign countries, give $2,000 to Americans.
He was right about that.
Americans go, no, we're not doing it. I mean, Trump's a good guy. He really cares about people.
Do you think that is that really what you envision him doing after he leaves the White House, is leading this populist movement? Or do you think he goes back to Mar-a-Lago and just kind of, you know, he's an older guy. You don't think he's just going to kind of fade away? Or do you really believe that he's going to be as aggressive as he's been?
Well, I mean, I'm not name dropping here. You know, I organized and fundraised the big events coming up next week on the 5th and 6th.
Right.
The giant events with millions of people in D.C. No one would step up. I did it.
Right. Right.
So I paid for it.
Right.
And then luckily a donor came and paid for like most of the $400,000.
Yeah.
$400,000. So again, Q thinks Trump's invincible. That's delusional pie in the sky. It had to be Alex Jones with the money stepping up. And then a donor stepped up and paid for most of it. And that's not me bragging. That's saying how pathetic this is. They're coming after Trump. His only power is to continue in the fight, to mobilize his donor base, to continue to fund him, to have money to promote America. They're trying to shut down the NRA, the same Southern District of New York, and Letitia James that works for George Soros. They're coming after everybody, brother. They're coming after anybody that promotes any form of capitalism or America. And so they're not going to let Trump go away. Just if he ran in the corner and stuck his head in the corner, they're going to eat his ass. You know, coyotes love sheep. And they love, because a sheep will put its head in the ground when it's surrounded by wolves, and it'll stick its ass out. And wolves love to eat them ass end. Okay, so here's the deal. I'm not getting eaten ass end, neither is Trump. And so, but it makes him more endearing how real he is and the fact that he's so surrounded. No, Trump is going to continue to fight. I'm going to continue to fight for America. And this is a lot bigger than President Trump.
Right. Do you ever, because we were on Rogan and you talked about, you have been doing this for so long and you've been, you know, on
the- I want to stay with you, but I'm supposed to go to the cemetery. Let them go ahead and leave in the armored vehicle and I'll meet them in the SUV down there once. I don't want to stop. The rally starts at 11. So go ahead and send Owen and then I'll just meet them after. Okay.
Yeah. Just
watch operations. I got plenty of time. Let's keep going.
You have been on the air for a very long time. Since when? When was the first year you were on the air? Do you remember in Austin?
1995, 94.
Okay. So you've been on the air coming, you know, 30 years, you know,
before that was Bill Hicks, but yeah.
Right. Before that you were Bill Hicks, and you were a very funny comedian. You've been on the air 30 years. You have been in the crosshairs of some very powerful people. You've been made like public enemy number one. Are you, is there a book that comes out? Is there a movie? Do you just tell your side of the story and put it out there so that people maybe years from now might want to hear your, because people are going to blacken your name and they have blackened your name and they've, you know, associated, they've taken one or two mistakes that you've made and they've said, this is this guy's whole career, or this is what he's about, or this is what he stands for. Do you eventually say, I want to put something out for posterity so that people know who I am, or get all your ideas and thoughts out, whether it's a book, whether it's a movie, whatever it is, so that something can live and you can have your side of the story out there?
Well, that's what happened is I knew 3-4 years ago when Trump won, they weren't spending hundreds of articles a day, every week, national TV shows, sometimes every day. I mean, we're talking Frontline. We're talking ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, CNBC, Al Jazeera, Japanese TV, Russian TV, BBC attacking me. I went, I'm not this important. They've chosen me to demonize me so that when they shut me down and when they deplatform us, because we were seeing the documents come out, we had people at Google leaking us stuff like they're planning a thing called deplatforming. It's like right when Trump got elected. So be careful and diversify right now. And boy, was that all true. And so they demonized me so people wouldn't stand up for me when they took me away. And then it was like dominoes. Like I said earlier, I said I was joking. I was joking about I can't talk about stuff, but I was being serious. They're having Senate hearings with computer scientists and witnesses, and Google says, we're not going to contest the election. That's not allowed, and bans Senate hearings. So that's the level we're at. And so let me tell you what happened. I forget all the names. Who's the guy that was one of the top? He wrote the big book about Motley Crue. I'm having one of those moments. He wrote the big book. He's written all the big books. He's the big biographer. He wrote the pickup artist book. What's his name?
Bugliosi, Vincent Bugliosi.
I interviewed Bugliosi too before he died a few times. He was that former prosecutor, like on the Manson
Strauss,
case.
Neil Strauss.
Yeah. Neil Strauss. Neil Strauss is a great guy. So Neil Strauss, right before my deplatforming, comes to town, meets with me, and he says, I want to write your book because I wrote something about Motley Crue, and I said, great, let's do it. So I signed an agreement with him that he could shop it around. They fire one of the biggest names. And then another lady called me, who was also big in books. They're all scared. CNN found out about it and said, you find the articles. Jones is about to get a big book deal. And they fired not Neil Strauss, but the two different major managers who were about to do deals on that. And they said, Jones doesn't get a book. Then they went through my catalog on Amazon of films I made years ago, like against the Nazis and stuff like Endgame. They banned those. And then there were all these filmmakers. Here's Werner Herzog. wanted to make a film like 10 years ago. Then they contact about 3 years ago. They go, yeah, we want to follow you for a year. Werner Herzog. And they go, oh, yeah, we got threatened. They had another Discovery Channel had already been following me before Trump for a year. I mean, we're talking they spent like $10 million with a major Academy Award winning documentary maker, not Werner Herzog, another one. There's not many that are Academy Award winning. People can figure it out. And he made a documentary about two brothers in upstate New York. I'll leave it at that. And they all flip and they killed a $10 million production. They already shot like 7 or 8 episodes. So you ask, yes, sir, I'm not allowed to tell the story. Right. You understand? I mean, so that's how this works is here's what happens. I used to cover internet controversies as part of the show. I kind of let the crew, I'm not blaming the crew, but it was the crew's issue. They would go, hey, this is really hot about this shooting in Connecticut. People aren't buying it. So I'd go, let's look at why people aren't buying it. Covered it like 10 times. Hart was like, you know, like imagine a huge timeline of your life, like a Final Cut Pro timeline, millions of cuts, hundreds of thousands of cuts. I mean, I put out like 40,000 videos on YouTube when they banned it. And they get like 10 videos and they zoom in and edit it and go, this is you. One joke you tell, one thing you do. And at first I'm like, apologize. I go, okay, I'm sorry. And then now I still get calls in the news. And they go, why are you threatening families and sending people to their homes to kill them? And so it's literally people living off the drama and my name saying, Alex is coming to get me. Alex is coming to hurt me. And then it's just fundraising. That's all it is. Hundreds of millions of dollars that group's raised. Hundreds, it's over $200 million now. They bankrupted Remington. They sued Remington, got rid of Remington. And I don't even blame the people, the families. It's that the lawyers, they just continue like these ghouls to just have articles like the New York Times. We just wish he'd stop living off us. We wish he'd stop making money off of us. And I never made any money off of them. Zero. There's thousands of stories every day. And so, you know, that's how this works. I mean, take WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks had thousands of emails that came out right before the election 4 years ago, 4 months and two, 4 years and 2 months ago. And I didn't progenerate that. I mean, hell, back then, Julian Assange was all over CNN, all over Fox News, this big hero, wouldn't give me the time of day. That's a whole other story, I'll tell you. And we're reading the WikiLeaks, and it's like, we love Aleister Crowley. We're having the Aleister Crowley event at this cabin in the woods. There will be small children in the hot tub ready for you. Now, they may misbehave. They are children, but they'll be there for your entertainment. We will have milk, blood, and semen for the ritual. And they're sending this to John Podesta. Blood, milk, semen. We're meeting at the farmhouse. Children will be waiting in the hot tub. So I go to Cancun for a week. And I come back and my crew's running around going, even CNN's reporting, it's all at a pizza place in D.C. There's basements. There's all this. So I look at it and I go, this is a setup. We've got all this stuff in the WikiLeaks. They're saying it's this place. CNN reported this. And my own crew goes, we thought you weren't that type of person to cover up something like this. And I went, don't you understand? We have the damn emails. It's in New York and it's in Chicago and it's $65,000 worth of hot dogs for Obama. That's male prostitutes. I said, the point is, the story is this over here. It is not this over there. That's the distraction. I said, look, 4chan says it. CNN picks it up. It's Q 1.0. And then sure enough, the media says, I said the pizza place. And none of it was true. So that's how, you ever seen how a mockingbird, if you get near its nest, falls down and acts like its wings broken? Yes. We were in New York documenting it. So they went, oh, pizzeria, D.C., look over here. And so I've learned how they operate. I've learned what they do. I learned how they get these jobs done. But I was saying, and I would tell you the rest of the story. I forget what that was.
Well, I mean, no, I mean, it's you cover all this stuff all the time and you have to make kind of split second decisions about the types of stories you cover. You cover them, you look into this stuff, and then you have fans. Some of those fans are rabid. Some of them are wild. Right. And then those fans did some horrible, indefensible, wild shit to these families, stuff they should have been in jail for, maybe are going to jail. I don't know. And I think, unfortunately, you know, it all becomes one thing, right? So instead of it's just...
Let's go further. Exactly. Like I heard like 5 years after that thing in Connecticut, I don't even say the name. They're like, I've been to people that never said their names. And it's like some schizophrenic woman goes to somebody's house and the judge goes, you promise not to ever go to InfoWars again, right? They connect me to this. You understand? And then as soon as Hillary ran $26 million worth of ads the last 2 weeks of the election of Trump likes Alex Jones, thinking it would hurt Trump, it actually boosted Trump with the grassroots. Once they did that, the left actually thought I ran Trump. I mean, I had some influence, but they took me from like a 2 on a Richter scale to a 50. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. You've actually, you know, your business and everything's taken a hit since for the last 4 years. I mean, that's, you know, it's
let's be clear. Before I got sued over the stuff in Connecticut and, you know, on the ongoing lawsuits and all that, as soon as Trump got in, it was like the money turned off. Because, oh, everything's fine. Trump's in. Everything's fixed. So people are thinking like I'm in there for Trump because I'm getting all this money. I really like Trump doing better deals with China. I like Trump, you know, trying to secure the border and standing up to the UN. But that doesn't mean I'm in a Trump cult. And so there was also another big fake news article. Roger Stone, 4 years ago, was there on election night in the studio right through there, the other studio, the older studio here in my complex. And he's like, man, we got the president. We're going to kick ass. This is great. Like 2 a.m. And I said, dude, he's an outsider. They're going to come after us now. The fight just began. And boy, he'll tell you I was right about that. The media spun that I was depressed because Hillary didn't get in and I didn't make more money. I don't give it. I mean, I got a decent house, and a nice car. I can buy all the enchiladas and beer I want. I don't measure things by money until I can't stay in business. Then I care about money. But I just want my speech. That's all I want is my speech. That's what I'm pissed off about. I just tell the story about Trump because it's not been a bed of roses, man. It's not been. I mean, we made so much money with Obama. I mean, people were pissed. They wanted to do something. And so if I was a sick person, I'd look forward to Joe Biden. But I'm fighting Joe Biden because he's a Chinese communist agent. Yeah. He didn't really get elected. And he's a piece of crap who can't even talk.
Ann Coulter has kind of admitted that she was wrong about Trump, that she was kind of taken for a ride. She said that he didn't do much and that, you know, there was not much done with immigration. Do you think at any point you will look back and say that you feel that you believed in Trump more than he deserved? Do you think in the future, is it at all possible that you'll look back at Trump and go, yeah, this guy was a billionaire from New York. He said a lot of the right things or things that you at the time agreed with, because Ann was a huge defender of him and a massive proponent of Trump.
Sure, she's the one that predicted that he was going to run first and win.
Right. But she has now kind of changed her tune and said he let Jared Kushner do a lot of things and he wasted a lot of opportunities. And she has said, I'm wrong about the guy. He's kind of a huckster. And do you believe that that's even possible down the road that you'll turn around and go, yeah, I put a little more faith in him than was deserved?
Look, I know the inside baseball on Ann Coulter. And I know the inside baseball on Matt Drudge, who does no interviews, did his last interview with me 5 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah, 5 years ago. And I like Ann, and I really love Matt Drudge. But, I mean, here's the deal. Did Trump refuse to spend any advertising money with Drudge when Drudge got him elected? Yes. But then does Drudge and Ann Coulter totally go to the Democrats 3 years ago and flip sides and then make a bunch of money? They did that so they wouldn't get deplatformed. And that's their decision. They helped get Trump elected. Trump didn't appreciate them after they did it. They were scorned. But to then say that he's this big fake and all that, no, that's not true. He does care about the country. He is real. He's made a lot of big mistakes. But I've been involved in some of those big decisions, and I really know what goes on in there. And so he is light years better than Joe Biden. And here's the thing. He could be a bad guy. If he really got elected and I saw the evidence, I would fight for him because I believe in our electoral process. He did win. That's a whole nother can of worms, a whole nother kettle of fish.
Yeah, there's a lot that, you know, there's too much noise out there. And I think a lot of people have no idea what's true and what's not. And then the media doesn't have.
Sure. I mean, let's go further, Tim, and I'll just tell you a story.
Yeah.
3 years ago, and I can't go too far into this because I signed non-disclosure agreements, but
Okay.
3 years ago, they filed 50-something lawsuits on us. Most of them totally petty. We've thrown out like 43 of them. I've spent, you know, I mean, let's not exaggerate, $10 million fighting this stuff. Right. Conservative. And that's going on. And they call your bank accounts up and they go, he's at our house harassing our children. Not talked about him ever. They're just doing that. It's like, I'm being harassed. I'm being stalked. Using dead kids to do it. But I mean, I can't get into this too much, but I mean, obviously there were major conservative nationalist organizations in the 90s that the Clintons bought out that are major household names that keep going along. Okay. And they did that fine, but they said, listen, separately, the lawsuits will end. All we want you to do is betray Trump and come out against the Second Amendment. And then we won't just stop all the lawsuits. How about, you know, this many millions of dollars every year guaranteed. So when the big boys came around, I mean, some of the richest people in the world, household names, and said, what's your price? My price was, I'm not signing on to you guys. You don't pay taxes. You're offshore. You pose as liberals. You run around doing all this. You fund Black Lives Matter and Antifa. You're trying to break the country up. And here comes Trump, who doesn't want to sell the country out. He makes a lot of mistakes, but he makes a lot of good decisions, taking you on. I'll be persecuted for that. And I'll be honest about Trump and his problems. But I'm going to explain something. For me, there were, hell, there still are, giant paychecks waiting. Because let me tell you something. In this world, these billionaires can buy anybody. It's like baseball cards. And I'm the baseball card they can't get. I'm the baseball card they've tried to buy. Brother, they offered me $1 million 20 years ago. They offered me 18 years ago, $3 million. 15 years ago, they offered me $10 million. But right before Glenn Beck came on the scene, they said, here's the contract. You'll get a Fox News show. I'm talking Roger Ailes, everybody. You're going to have a book a year. Everything will be handled. You live in New York or LA, your choice, or Miami. You will get $10 million a year. You will have a national show. You will have a book deal. You will have everything you want. You like this chick? She wants to suck your dick right now. Super hot chick. She's ready to fuck you right now. Just sign this contract, because you can either be on this crusade that's going to fail or be the star you are. But it doesn't matter how much charisma you've got or how much passion, Jones, you don't make it without us. Well, guess what, motherfuckers? I did make it, and I'm going to burn your fucking ass down. And I make more money than I ever made with you, and I don't give a shit about that, but I'm keeping score, and I'm going to defeat your New World Order, Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos and all of you. So burn in fucking hell.
There it is. Alex Jones, that's the finale. You are an American original. I will fund the documentary about you. I will make it. We will go around the censors. We'll fucking make the documentary about you. Thank you for coming on. Happy New Year.
Thank you, Alex.
I'll see you down there in Austin, my friend. Be careful yelling at the governor from your tank.
All right, I will. Be safe. Right.
Thank you, brother.
Infowars.com and band.video. They're not supposed to find us anywhere. People say all the time, like, shake my hand, like, I wish you were still on air. I'm on air. Infowars.com, band.video. Love you guys.
Infowars.com, band.video. Alex Jones going to the W Hotel to yell at the mayor of Austin.
Shoot at the hotel.
In a tank where Tina 40 will then lead 100 people.
It's there's a lot of action tonight. There's a lot of action.
A lot of action, man. You almost feel
like a fast lob, not doing anything.
You feel bad for Alex almost because like I've always thought Trump's a huckster, and I've sure. always believed that. And I feel like he doesn't, and he knows Trump.
Well, he's an idealist.
Yeah. I mean, I don't, you know,
we're cynics. We're like, we think everyone's a scam.
Yeah. I don't see the evidence that Trump is really doing it, but I mean, no. Alex really truly believes it's like, it's kind of, there's a sadness to it. But Alex obviously is an adult and knows what he's doing and, you know, knows Trump and feels a certain way. I've seen no evidence that Trump is really wants to help people.
Not a single person. but
evidence. Hey, I'm open-minded. I don't know. I haven't been in those. No billionaires come to me and said you can have $1 million.
I think he wants to hurt some people.
Yeah. I think that Trump's an interesting guy because I think a lot of his ideas
are probably good.
Right.
But then the space between the, and some of them are not, but the space between the idea and the execution is doesn't exist.
Well, yeah, it's a little rough. It's a little, it's a rough patch in between.
It's a little rough. And, you know, we've got, what is it? 11 PM East Coast.
No, it's almost midnight.
No.
It's 8:57.
What does that mean?
3 minutes until it drops in New York.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah.
We should have kept him on. I didn't realize that. We could have did the fucking New Year's.
We had to go. The producer was texting me.
Oh, the producer
was a security issue.
I had no idea. Well, this is, we got 3 years for New Year's. I love the two.
I need a new hat because the dog is eating my hat. What is it? Have the band?
Oh, I got another one.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Ben just texted me. Ben was like, yeah, this producer will. The producer is, you know, saying
it got dense there. I got a little confused in the middle of it. Wasn't sure.
Well, there's a lot going on.
There's
a lot going on. I mean, he's the most entertaining person ever.
Sure.
And, you know, he's also very passionate about a lot of things. And
you think he liked me? Like,
yeah, I think he liked.
Okay. Him. It seemed like he wanted to like grab me at one point.
Yeah, I think that would have happened if we're in a physical studio. I mean,
right.
But I don't know.
I was just trying to, you know, play devil's advocate and try to get some, you know. But I think he thought it was like
an
agent provocateur.
Okay. I mean, listen, man. I mean, he is, you want to talk about fascinating American lives. He's got one.
Yeah.
You know,
no, I don't agree with everything he says. I mean,
of course.
The COVID stuff, in my opinion, holes in it. But that being said, there's been a lot of stuff over the years he's been really right about.
A lot of stuff. I don't think anyone knows about COVID in terms of like 3 years. We're going to look back and know a lot more about it.
Sure.
But in terms of the show that we did, which is Tim Dillon's Going to Hell, we talked to a lot of interesting people. This guy's, you know.
Oh, most interesting. Sure.
And that's the stuff that we covered for years. You know, we covered a lot of that stuff. And he's been more successful covering it than anyone else. More than Nick Bryant, Russ Baker, more than David Talbot, more than John Kiriakou, more than anyone that we've had on our show.
Right.
Alex has gotten the biggest. He's gotten the crosshairs of the most people. He's certainly been the loudest. And I guess we got to do a fucking New Year's countdown. Okay, it's a minute till New Year's.
What's?
Can you bring up the ball, Ben?
Bring for up the goddamn ball.
Jesus Christ. It's New Year's, everybody. What a year. It's Times Square. Now, no one is going to be creepy. No one's allowed out, right? Oh, wait, what?
Six, 11, 3.
Wait a minute. Are people out?
2, 1.
What a sad fucking New Year. What a tragedy, huh?
The longer people be forgotten all the way.
People are in Times Square.
I mean, who? There are people. This is bizarre. Who are you?
What the fuck?
It's New Year's. Lucy, come on camera a second.
Come on camera. Ray's girlfriend, lovely Lucy.
Hello.
Yay.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
I mean, this with the masks. I mean, wow.
Hello, Oscar. What's his dog's name again?
Duncan. Oscar's the cat.
Right, of course.
Is that de Blasio and his wife? I'm leaving. What the fuck's going on? Why can't I go to Fridays? Oh, there's no one there.
There's like 30 people.
There's like 30 people. Why are the de Blasios dancing? What the fuck is going on?
They're about to blow up bubblegum shrimp, that's why.
Where's Al-Qaeda? Where the fuck's Al-Qaeda? Can someone get Al-Qaeda to Times Square, please? This is a real fucking disappointment.
Oh, even this year, you had to put a Kia ad in the fucking thing.
Oh, God, Kia.
This is disgusting.
Get Kia. It's the best truck to transport bodies.
Here's the thing about Alex Jones. Why does he think we deserve him?
I know. It's true. Yeah. Look at this. I mean, what a tragedy. Turn this off. This is grotesque.
That's enough.
There's 25 people in the street dancing. Why is that even allowed?
It looks like the end of a zombie film.
It's the end of it is the end of a zombie right. film. It's called The United States. I mean, this is fucking crazy.
This is an American tragedy.
Deeply tragic. But there is something that will solve it.
The longest lance. The spear of
Well, we found an artist.
Yes.
We found a woman.
A woman. Right.
We found someone.
Look, we found a glimmer of light,
a glimmer of hope
in the darkness,
in a very dark time.
Yes.
And the woman's name is Tina Parole. Tina Parole, for those of you who didn't know, had a hit song 11 years ago. It was not a hit.
Well, it was on the radio.
It was on the radio.
I don't know if that counts as a hit.
It was a feminist anthem.
It's a divorced woman's anthem, at least.
It's called Who's Got Your Money Now? Who's Got Your Money Now is a catchy song.
Yeah.
And one of the worst music videos that has ever been made.
It's atrocious. It's insulting how bad it is.
Tina Parole, marginally attractive, but the faces she makes her look like just terrifying.
Yeah.
Ben said it. He goes, she could play a 50-year-old in any sitcom ever.
Right.
Tina Parole does a song where a man she's apparently dating is not calling her back.
I think she's supposed to be a prostitute, though.
I don't think she's supposed to be a prostitute, right? Okay. She steals the man's money.
Right.
She takes his credit cards.
Or John's money. Whatever.
Whatever. And then one of the lines of the song is, I called your mother and asked for your social security number. This was part of the feminist icon music of like the Blue Cantrell, hit 'em up style. I'll get your money. You've cheated on me. I'll take your money. And so Tina, they put some work into this. Now, Tina's from upstate New York. We know someone who knows her. And this song, which we'll play in a little bit, led us to another song called Better Life.
Right.
Where she sang.
Look, it's the most touching immigration story of all time.
Right. She's talking about her parents who came from Poland to America after the Berlin Wall fell.
Right.
So after communism had ended and...
Yeah, it seems like, you know, because Poland is like the linchpin of the end of the Cold War.
Right.
It's like the Pope gets involved.
Right.
Poland gets liberated. And like I think like a year or two later, the Berlin... So I don't know what they were...
So it's her war criminal parents leave Poland... And end up in New York. She writes a song about it, which she performs to an empty stadium.
Right.
Which is the saddest thing that anyone's ever seen.
10 people in the dugout and then the rest of it's empty.
This is the pop star that America deserves. Right. And we found her. We became obsessed with her. I've become obsessed with Tina Parole. I can't sleep. I can't eat. I wake up every day and I think about Tina Parole. Right. I think about the scene in this music video where they pick her up and her little baby legs kick. And it's the most disgusting thing I've ever seen.
It's the most labored I've ever seen. And she's not like a big fat woman or anything.
No.
But it's the most, she must have like very dense bones because it's the most labored I've ever seen the lifting of
a
woman.
Can you just move the dog? Because the dog is eating the bone by the microphone. That's okay. Yeah, it's just. We do have a guest coming on too, Randy.
This dog is a monster. Yes, yes.
Well, please, I want to watch this music video. If you get on the Tina Parole train, folks, you'll never get off it.
I had a feeling cause you're not calling. You say no, but people been talking. Followed you around the block. Saw her, she ain't even hot.
She looks 46. Right?
She looks like Strong Young when she showed up in the studio to be Catwoman.
Choose Joy. The bag. Oh, choose Juicy.
The mailman.
You are broke. She opens a note, says you're broke. Okay. Now, I mean, this is the most disgusting. There's no dancing. There's no choreography. It's like on some street in Long Island City.
With a paper roll and a wrist.
Yeah. She really thought this was happening, Tina Parole. She was really thought this was going to happen when this happened.
It's hard to believe how much I did for you. Everyone knew how much I adored you.
God.
But that's that, and I ain't looking back.
It's like an old, it's not even like a fancy car. It's like an old, like fucking Chevy or something.
You know, she thinks she's like, she's got that weird, like, Leah Remini, like, little leather jacket. And
hey, we have a nice Oldsmobile. We got money.
I mean,
what, these guys who work at fucking T-Mobile?
So this was 11 years. Oh God! Run that back again, Ben. Show this. Show this is sadder than the most tragic elderly woman she's with. Watch them lift her up and her legs. Oh God!
Look at her eyes.
Yeah, I mean it's scary. What happened with that shot was they lifted her up and she was supposed to like kick her legs and it looked so bad that they said let's just cut her legs out entirely.
Let's just cut her legs
off. A fan just sent that. Tina Parole finally responded publicly to not doing the show.
Mention me in a comment. She said,
because people were tweeting, Instagram commenting at her.
Yeah, she goes, didn't work out this New Year's Eve because of other obligations, but def another day. So Tina Parole. Now, by the way, we wanted to have Tina Parole on the show.
Look, we spent all week.
We spent all week trying to get Tina Parole on the show because the woman fascinates.
And look, we agents, managers.
We tried to do everything to get Tina Parole for you people. And let's get the other song. Please get Better Life. Because this is when you notice this woman, God love her, but she's really living her dream, and it's just a shitty dream that isn't coming true.
Right.
And she's at a stadium and there's no one there, and she's singing about her immigrant parents. By the way, everyone's from Poland. Shut up, you're white. Shut up. Everyone's from fucking Poland. Like, everyone comes from Europe.
I'm a quarter Polish.
Who cares? And she's at this stadium and she's singing this song, and it is the worst song I've ever heard. Like, it's catchy, but the lyrics are the worst.
So I write songs professionally for a lot of other artists, this one felt like mine.
God help us.
I wrote it with my great friends, Margaret Valentine and Sarah Emily Berrios.
Three people wrote this. Jesus.
And it's about my parents. And so they're here tonight. Love you guys. They're immigrants. They came here from Poland.
I feel so bad shitting on this because you could tell
she's a better life. And I think we can all relate. We all just want our family.
You'll see why.
People we love to have a better life. So
that's her, that's her dad. They're hugging.
That you feel that way about, okay?
I'll explain why.
My mom and dad. My whole family.
Oh, God.
Here we go.
Here we go. By the way, stop this for a second. You'd think what's about to happen is like a belt out.
Epic.
She's going to epic, like, belt out, like,
fireworks.
You think she's about to, like, really go for it.
My dad killed babies.
Right. Why were they kicked out of 200 countries? You know.
You got to break a few eggs.
Yeah. You'd think it would be some, like, beautiful alt-right anthem.
Yeah.
What she does here is an atrocious, like, Macklemore type of thing. And she's singing about the Berlin Wall. It's mind-blowing. Please, folks, light the joint, take a shot, and enjoy, who's responded publicly on Instagram, and I'm probably going to have to call my lawyer tomorrow. I'm already in it with an Airbnb, but I guarantee I'm getting a call from a lawyer within the next week. Please enjoy, truly... truly one of the least talented people in this country. But she's done so much with it. Like, the level of talent versus what she's done with it, I respect her more than Whitney Houston, more than Tina Turner.
It's like a fashion model wearing garbage bags.
Yes, but even worse. Right. Somehow worse. Please enjoy Tina Parole. Better Life. Oh, God.
She's really feeling it.
Because she's like, this is my moment. My parents are here. I'm in this stadium with 19 people.
We only get one shot.
The backdrop of the love story was the Eastern Bloc and the Berlin Wall. A waitress and a bartender fell.
She's got the bedazzled Doc Martens.
Everything they'd ever known. A new country, new language, new home. They didn't want to, but they had to go. So they jumped into
the unknown. She says go, she points
up. All they wanted was a better life. Sometimes when I'm complaining, I'm like, who am I? I can't imagine being 28 getting off an airplane at JFK with $75 in a suit.
That's the chorus. Stop it. The chorus is, I can't imagine getting off an airplane to JFK with $75 in my pocket, which back then was probably a good amount of money.
I can't imagine being asked if I want cheese crackers or a potato chip.
I can't imagine what it's like getting off a JFK with $3,700 at an apartment I could stay in for 6 months or whenever I needed to.
Being given the contact by the Stasi.
I mean, keep going with this. This is real, real rough.
They started at the bottom, so then every day when I wake up, that I'm not where I thought I would be. For all they gave up, I thought greatness had to be in my destiny.
Sometimes I get so down, but they say that I'm enough when they're already proud. Cause I've got fire and fight in my blood. I'm made of what they're made of. Just wanna give them a better life. Sometimes when I'm complaining,
the singing
I'm like,
so bad. My parents were Nazis. They put Jews in barrels. But that's okay, cause now they own a deli in fucking Manhattan Avenue. Dead alive. Her uncle is cool like Goebbels. Most of my She's singing about Operation Paperclip.
Most of my family's in Argentina.
You a better life. They called it Operation Paperclip. They were scientists that put acid in the mouth of kids just to see what happened. We gotta defeat people.
They asked my dad, can you build a spaceship? He said, I just kill kids.
They brought me here to wear Doc Martens in the stadium and sing real shitty. Oh yeah, she's trying to get the wave going and nothing's going. People are so confused, like, what's going on? All the people there are like, we hate immigrants. This is uncomfortable. They're like, can you write a song about people staying where they are?
Thank you for a better life.
A better life. I have no idea why she, I don't know why she wouldn't come on the show.
Thank you so
much. Why would
much.
You not come on the show? We're fans.
Look, you want to feel bad for her? Remember, listen to the other song, the horror song, the one about the prostitute, whatever it's about. I don't know.
What? Yeah.
Oh, like, look, I've said this before. I have made my career being an honest man.
Right.
Being a humble man.
Right.
And not trying to act like I'm better than I am. And this fucking Jersey, whatever, upstate rat is acting like, well, I go to Ibiza. Yeah, and like, I can't stomach it. So I'm not going to feel bad.
We don't feel bad for him.
Right. We're not going to cry.
I do, you know, our opinions are what they are.
Look, this is a free country.
Yes.
For now. She's allowed to, you know, philander about.
Allowed to do that. Now, she shouldn't be.
No, she shouldn't be. But she's
some secret police should stop
right.
this.
Look,
if China will stop this, I'll put whatever needle in me they want.
If there's any,
whatever vaccine, President Xi, if you stop this shit from happening, I'll take all the vaccines.
The best counter argument to the idea that there's a new world order is that Tina Parole is allowed to just, you know, flail about in this country.
Right. It's like if Tina Parole can make it.
Right.
Come on. And now she's doing good things.
She's involved in other projects. I mean, she's getting.
She writes songs for like Disney and shit.
People like it, I guess. People enjoy a lot of things.
We'd love her to still come on. We would love her to come on. I respect what you've built.
Look, it's hustle. It's pure hustle. There isn't
any, pure hustle.
There's zero.
There's not a shred of actual talent or anything.
It is just an engine running on fumes.
Hey, it's her loss, man. Yeah. We wanted her to come on and sing this Better
might
Life.
This might have gone differently if we heard it live.
Well, we were going to do this and then bring her on
right.
and then say, please come sing Better Life.
Right. And then we were all saying, Alex may have sung with her. You know, we were the Tina 40 might came back and sung. We would have had a
Better Life, motherfucker. I had COVID. I don't give a fuck.
We're going to bum rush the calendar.
We're still going to run a Starbucks with no masks and spit in your face because I don't care about the COVID life. Who am I, motherfucker?
I carry World War II vests on my back. Try to grab
is
my
that
ass.
What a Spartan race is? She goes, I carry wounded warrior. What's going on?
I'm just picturing some like 80-year-old man trying to grab her ass as she runs down.
She's just running with Lindy England on her back. I carry these fucking soldiers from Abu Ghraib, motherfucker. I carry Guantanamo Bay guards on my back doing Spartan races. Man.
I mean, Tina Parrell. So listen, I'm gonna get out of for a few minutes because we have a guest you're gonna interview.
Right.
And this is you've met a young incel.
You're
mentoring.
I'm trying to get him out of the life, but of inselling.
Of inselling. Yeah. Okay. Well, listen, let's see how that works.
Hello, welcome Randy to the show.
What's up, Cox?
Hey.
Chip Dillon 2024. I'm a pig.
You're a pig?
You're
slap is served?
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of you.
So you're not a big fan of me?
No.
Why is that?
Because you're a cuck.
I'm a cuck?
Yeah, you sold out to the female lie.
The female lie?
I don't. I'm 12 years old. I've been incel. I've been having a hard time this year. None of the girls in my Zoom classes are letting me get my dick in.
Okay. Well.
And people tell you, you got to wait. You're only 12 years old. You got to wait. You got to work out.
Why do you think they don't want to let you get your dick in?
I don't know. They're all dogs.
Okay.
But people tell you, you got to wait until your voice changes. You got to wait until you grow some muscle. But these whore teachers are fucking kids younger than me. So you tell me what's going on.
That's a fair point, Randy. What did you think of Tina 40?
I thought she was great. I mean, ultimately, she's a typical femboy, but I do think she's trying to do the right thing.
Okay.
It's stopping the steal, and I respect that.
Are you a big Trump supporter?
I love Donald Trump. I'm sick with how he's been treated. Though I don't think that he should give Ivanka so much airtime.
Oh, you think he spends too much time with Ivanka?
No, I think she's manipulating him.
Do you think you relate to Barron? Is Barron someone like you get along with?
Barron's a cool dude. He looks like a guy who would subscribe to my Twitch stream.
Are you? And what do you do in your Twitch stream?
I review movies like Wonder Woman and Captain Marvel.
What'd you think of Wonder Woman?
I thought it sucked.
And what'd you think of Captain Marvel?
I thought it sucked.
Do you like any movies with women in it?
I like Alien a lot. I think Sigourney Weaver has a really dignified presence.
Okay.
So, but I don't know. I don't know why I'm like this. I know you're trying to tell me I'll grow up and things will get better. But, right. Being a Chad, you don't really know what you're talking about.
I'm a Chad.
Yeah.
What makes me a Chad?
You're just like, you walk through life and you just get pussy like that, like a snap of your fingers, and you just flex your morgue job and girls want to have sex with you.
I mean, I'll be honest with you. The morgue job wasn't the pussy magnet that you think it is. But, it's like you might have to wait a little time. Why are you in such a rush to have sex?
I don't know. I think it goes back to my childhood when I was a young boy, my mother. She was very neglectful. There would be a man would come over and he would take tasteful nudes of her in the basement. And the two of them would go in the basement.
They would go in the basement?
And they would go in the basement and there's a studio and they would leave me alone. I wouldn't know where they went. And so,
some man came over and took nude photographs of your mother in the basement?
Yeah, he took black and white nudes. And one time I went into the basement and I saw my mother's nipple and I cried and I called the police on her because I saw her nipple.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
And did they arrest her?
They arrested her and I testified against her in court for child abuse.
Oh my God. Wow.
She went to prison, which she should have.
Yeah. She sounds like a real whore.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So, who'd you live with? Your dad?
I lived with my dad and I got very sick and I had to go to the hospital and
sick with what? What kind of illness?
My body doesn't produce fluids like other boys do.
Really? Wow. Wow, that sounds terrible.
They had to take all the blood out of my body and spin it around.
That sounds like a devastating wow.
Yeah.
So that you feel like that makes you want to just, pump fluid into women now.
Yeah, I wanted to prove that I have fluid in my body, that the fluid works sometimes.
Well, I understand that. That sounds like a wow. Okay. Well, this is do you have any girls at school that you might want to?
I don't know. It's a tough time for dudes. It's a tough time for guys with weak chin lines because, there's a lot of with Kamala Harris coming into the White House that she propagates the lie to she lies to women about their biology. And so women out there think they have all these options. And so that means I can't be with my looks match, who's Billy Bobby Brown.
A looks match, is that an insult term?
It's the person you would be with in the wild.
Oh.
And so if you nature.
Oh, so you would be with the girl from Stranger Things.
I would be with Millie Bobby Brown. She would gratefully have my children.
Really? do you think that she's kind of a dirty like the fact that she won't have your children makes her kind of
I just say I feel bad for her because obviously her eggs are drying up like crazy right now.
Sure.
She only has a few years left and then she's going to be sad that she didn't get with Randy. But, you know, it's because her eggs are all dried up. She'll want to be with me, but I'm not going to want to be with her because you can't be with a woman with dried up eggs.
Sure. Well, Randy's going to have the last laugh.
It's just an emasculating. You're just coming into a dried up hole that other men have used.
And that's a Scott. You don't want the sloppy seconds of Millie Bobby. We shouldn't be talking about a young child. This just seems wrong, man.
I'm a kid. It's okay for me. You're a pedophile. That's a good
point. Well, I'm not a pedophile, but thank you for, look.
She's older than me. I'm 12 years old.
Fair enough. I hope it works out for you. I hope it works out, Randy. Are you into sports at all?
I'm a little bit into sports. I don't watch sports anymore because all of those guys, you know, they're all, you know, they're acting self-righteous. They're a bunch of chads and they act self-righteous.
Okay.
They say that, you know, you should support this or that cause, but you know, it's like they're, you know, I just want
them to shut up and play is what you're saying.
Just shut up and play. And also I'm hard. You know, I'm watching LeBron James talk about all these issues and he's a tall, handsome man and I'm just hard.
He is a handsome man.
I'm hard and it hurts all the time.
Okay, because you're handsome. He's a handsome man, objectively, but I thought you wanted women.
Well, yeah, but I'm just saying, I don't need some, like, big, handsome guy who gets all the girls he wants telling me that I need to do something when it hurts, when my whole body hurts all the time with how hard I am.
Sure, I mean, you seem, I don't want to comment on how hard you are, but, all right, well, Randy, this has been a... I really hope it works out for you in 2021. I hope you get some pussy.
Thanks for mentoring me, Ray. It's been a lot to me.
Look, thanks for coming on the show, and I wish you the best. We'll talk soon.
All right.
Randy, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you know, I've always said, Tina Parole is outside with a gun, and she's not happy. Tina Parole is not happy. I'm dealing...
Parker, stop staring at Lucy, then. It's creepy.
I'm dealing with a massive fallout from the parole camp, by the way.
Are you?
Yeah.
What happened?
They're upset.
About what?
About her. She was depicted. They feel unfairly.
By me?
By both of us.
All right. Well, I mean, we said she has a great spirit.
I know, but they're very angry about
parole.
Tina Parole.
I've been 40.
No, Tina Parole's, Tina Parole's people are very angry right now.
What are they doing? They called you?
Well, they reached out.
Oh, really?
And
well, it took them a while, didn't it?
Well, because they've kind of been getting the gist of what's been going on, and they think that we're trying to make a fool of her.
Well, yeah, maybe the better agent's move would be to call when we ask.
They're very angry, and they're explaining to me that this is a woman who just wants a better life.
Look.
And they said that her family is not Nazi war criminals.
We didn't say they were Nazi war.
We alluded to it strongly.
We just
and
speculated.
They feel that it was wrong to say that her parents were Nazi war criminals. They wanted to clarify. They said that her parents did work for the government in a low-level capacity and that everything they did was in accordance with their own moral code and that they wanted to explain to us that different times there's different... moral universes at different times throughout history and that whatever they did should not be judged by the standards of today. And well, I mean, look, that's kind of what they reached out and
I understand where you're coming from.
I mean, Tina Parole is basically saying, listen, my parents did what they had to do. She's texting me right now. She just texted me and said, you fat fuck, my parents have done what they had to do, okay? She said did what they had to do to give me a better life. Sorry, your Irish potato famine pigs didn't give you a better life.
You were just saying
Tina Parole right here in Texas.
You were just saying a week ago you wish your dad moved to a better neighborhood when you were a kid.
I wish my father was performing experiments on children like Tina Parole's family was.
I can't argue with just, you know, the love of a child. You'll do anything for it. You'll kill anyone.
I'm just upset and disappointed in Tina Parole. I'm also upset this Airbnb, this cunt on Airbnb, and I did threaten. I may be getting kicked off Airbnb.
That's safe bet.
Because I did threaten. The woman who rented us a home in Joshua Tree.
Yeah.
Who then texted me and asked.
A dump.
a dump. And there were parts of it that were nice, natural, sure, whatever. But it was one of these houses where every piece of furniture is an art piece.
Right.
It's like cowhide chairs that no one can fucking fit in and everything. And she said, I was a horrible guest, and we clogged your toilets, we broke her stools, and we ruined the house.
First of all, her and her wife,
I think.
Yeah.
These lesbian designers. And let's get honest with, let's gay men design with the lesbian. Can you stop with the lesbian designing? Can we cut that out, please? Enough. Know your strengths. Exactly. It might be building house. It's not designing it.
I will say this. I don't clog toilets. If I clog a toilet, I reach in and I grab it. That being said.
Right.
Those holes in those toilets were the smallest toilet holes I've ever seen.
They were for tiny little shits that lesbians take in the middle of the desert after they've been on drugs. It's not my fault you're on drugs. Stop taking DMT in the desert and trying to, I'll give you a breakthrough. Your house sucks. You don't need fucking to go into hyperspace to figure out the problem.
Yeah.
So these whores wrote on Airbnb that I clogged a toilet, that we broke stools, okay? We didn't break the dumb fucking chairs were concrete.
First of all,
cinder blocks.
They were not concrete cinder blocks. They were made of drop ceiling tile.
Yeah.
They were made of crumbly material.
And then she said we broke a cactus. How do you even do that, you goofy bitch? Shut the fuck up.
They had
sloppy
a cactus
whore.
That was just like hung together with like string.
Literally. It was hung together by string to look like it was sewed together.
Yeah. These people are monsters.
They're disgusting. And she wrote, I was a horrible guest. And she texted me before this. She goes, give us 5 stars to keep us on Airbnb. So I responded to her. I said, listen, nobody broke anything. Your house sucks. The furniture is unusable. You're not artists. Your home is wildly overpriced. You begged me for a good rating and then trust me. The cleaning crew complained about cleaning, which they did. She goes, they complained they had to clean. Yeah. I was like, who's your cleaning crew? I was like, there were some dishes and that was all.
Yeah, look, you pay $400
for cleaning.
It's not a big house. It's like, oh, sorry, you couldn't make a profit off the cleaning.
Clean it, okay? I said to her, I said, I don't care about your reviews. I don't rent out my home to strangers like an animal. Good luck with everything in the future. The place is a dump that looks like it was furnished by drug addicts, which I imagine you are. If you need help, I'll take you to an AA or NA meeting. Go to IKEA and get some actual furniture, which hopefully you can afford. Not everything has to be an art piece. And feel free to use the tartar sauce I left behind later, pig. Now go to my story, because this wasn't the real problem.
Right. No, that's totally above board.
The real problem was I texted her and I got in my head a little and I got in my feelings about this. Okay. And so I texted her. I said this to the Airbnb host. I said, I know where your house is. Hopefully nothing happens to it.
Right.
And she wrote back, are you threatening me? And I wrote, stay safe in 2021. And she wrote, haha, you too, bro. And then I wrote, we'll see who's laughing.
Which I don't think is necessarily a threat.
Shit, no. And then I sent her a gif of the Simpsons house on fire.
Right. Well, that makes it a little more.
This is what I did to this woman. And then I blocked her because not to block her, but I couldn't control what I was going to do. So there is a chance at Airbnb that we're not able to do it.
I mean, at the very least, maybe you get a couple of weeks off.
Hey, at the end of the day, all we do, all me and you have done.
Right.
Is trying to get treated like human beings on this planet. And it's, not once.
It's so hard to be a person for us.
Not once are we treated like human beings.
We just want to feel like gentlemen for one day.
Just treat us like a gentleman. I don't want to sit on your marble stool or whatever.
It's like, look, I had to sit on it was like a petrified log.
Yes, we made baked beans in your house and there's a pot of beans that weren't clean and beans explode.
Yeah.
And there's a pot of exploded beans in the house.
We just figured that professionals would be better able to handle it.
What are we going to do? And yes, we got the Gorton's fish, which was very nice. The Gorton's planks.
Yeah, they're good.
The breaded fish and tartar sauce. And so there is a fish smell because we hate the Gorton's fish.
Look.
What do you want us not to eat?
In the middle of Joshua Tree, you want us to find fresh seafood?
No, we got a perfectly fine plank seafood. Gorton's fits. Planks, it's the fillets.
Delicious.
Pre-breaded fillets.
Was she a classist?
Right. So we did some fillets in the oven.
Sure.
And we made beans. And burgers.
And we spilled some tartar sauce, maybe.
A little tartar sauce got spilled. And then we brought 7 pints of ice cream to all test the little ice creams. And then there's a dairy smell that didn't compliment the fish.
No.
But what are we supposed to do? But then she's like, we broke furniture. Nobody broke furniture.
No, there's no broken furniture. No.
And we didn't clog any of the toilets. I think our systems handled it very well, considering.
I think I took a very, because the ice cream are very soft shit.
Right.
You were shitting
soft.
Yeah.
You dumb bitch.
Your story sounds fishy.
He's shitting liquid on your bowl, and you have a problem with that? Look, what's wrong with you? Are they sick?
I'm going to start taking pictures of my shits now, just in case this happens.
Maybe that's not a bad idea. Should I text message her a picture of diarrhea and say, that's what we were shitting in your bowl, you dumb bitch?
We ate beans, ice cream, and fish. What do you think we were doing?
Yeah. Nobody's coming in with hard, fucking salad shits.
Right. No, this is a real smash and grab, as we used to say.
Well, I'm going to report them to Airbnb, and I'm going to say that they raped us.
You should call the cops on her. I mean, honestly, we should. Not enough people come forward when they're raped. We should
call. Yeah. I will call the cops and report a fake rape.
I will bloody my ass and then use it as evidence.
So if you're in Joshua Tree, do not rent that home.
Right.
I don't know. I don't want to tell you where it is, but do not rent the home. Mila and Jonah, we work so hard on our home. And then she's like, when you're staying in a corporate hotel with a lot of investors, I get it. But when you're staying in a home that was like curated by us, we worked for years on it, and for you guys to disrespect it and trash it. And I'm like, no one trashed your house. No one trashed your house.
We spent years.
Dramatic.
The stupid chairs are made of like dumb cow leather. The cows are like get like pestilence.
Yeah. You spent years stealing the culture of Native Americans and adorning your home with it. That little buffalo skull. That's what you spent years putting a buffalo skull in the turlet.
These are white women.
Yes.
Who,
of course they are.
I picture them with their hand in the blood of a buffalo, but also a dead Native American child, and just wiping it to moisturize their face. That's what they're doing to this fucking
Doing, and then it's somehow our fault, just because we wanted to go. I wanted to show you the desert and your lovely bride, the desert.
Yeah.
I mean, look, and then we went to Vons, that store. Everybody's walking around like a desert rat in camo.
I'm sorry they didn't have sushi at Vons.
Yeah, I'm sorry we couldn't have food without odors. Sorry, we couldn't get food without odors. We couldn't eat pokeballs. We ate lovely Gorton's fish fillets.
The kale soup at Vons wasn't fresh.
Sorry we couldn't eat kale soup. I'm sorry we didn't go to your house and take ayahuasca like the rest of the drug addicts you rent to. Yeah. We wanted to have an American fucking meal and not junk it up. Okay, you junk box. You know that Ben pointed out a chair. He goes, that's the tripping chair.
Yeah. Right.
Somebody said, what did you explain that again?
It's a bright orange chair next to a little fire pit in the middle of the dirt. It's for tripping. You take ayahuasca.
Well, for eating Gorton's fish when we rent it.
They had a toilet outside, which normally I get. It's the desert. Why not? But it wasn't even enclosed.
Oh, it's my cousin who I don't like. Let's answer him. Hey, man.
Hey. Joe, Happy New Year, Cole.
Happy New Year, buddy. What are you up to?
Just chilling my apartment again.
That's awesome, dude. Have a good New Year. What are your plans?
Just chilling with us. Maybe Pearl Harbor, the new Pearl Harbor, maybe 4 hours back,
Okay. Well, that's cool, buddy. I'm working right now, but I love you and give my best to everyone. I hope to see you soon.
To hear your voice, Tim. Happy New Year.
Thank you very much.
Well, that was lovely. That was a lovely. Your family's terrible.
I mean, really horrible.
I hate your family.
I mean, and people say it's me. Is it me?
No, your family is. Is I only like my family, and your family's worse somehow.
I mean, they're bad. These people. Yeah. First of all, he doesn't buy the live stream.
Right. And this guy.
Who is this person?
This is the guy I know, right?
The guy that comes into the comedy shows drunk and stands up and yells.
This guy is a drunk animal monster. Every time I've ever seen him, he comes onto the live stream and does that. Nothing. Doesn't start yelling about his crazy father.
Yeah, could do something cool. They can't even waste our time.
We're sorry.
Yeah, good. He'll be a good Airbnb host.
Yeah.
I mean, so do you think there's a chance they throw him off Airbnb for threatening this woman?
I think that.
And I didn't threaten her. I just said, I hope nothing happens to your house. I was being nice. I hope nothing happens.
Did you pay for the hot tub to be hot, by the way? Because it wasn't hot. It was like 97 degrees.
No, she said, give me $200 for the pool heat. I said, fuck you, because the pool wasn't heated.
Do I think there's a chance they throw you off? I'll answer saying this. I do think there is an assault on freedom in this country. Yes. So, yes.
Agreed. That's all right. I can always use Carney's Airbnb or VRBO, or I'll have him start an account, or I'll start an account with a fake phone number, a burner phone, and a new debit card, a fake name. What are you, stupid?
A Google number. It's easy.
Who cares?
You do sound like a stalker saying, "What, are you going to get a restraining order? I'll fucking come find you. I'll come. Yeah, you're going to stop it. The cop, you'll be dead by the time the cops come."
Hey, love is love. That's what I'm saying. I like, and she said it was a luxury retreat. There's nothing luxurious about it.
No.
There's nothing luxurious. 50- it's that desert, and Varg is in the room. He would like that stuff because he loves drugs. But it's that real kind of like, you know, I like plush, luxurious rugs.
Right.
Old Hollywood glamour.
Even the couch, I couldn't sit. Like, you sit there. I
can't sit on
it. No lumbar.
No, this furniture is for sitting while you fucking, I don't know, brew tea out of shrooms and then take it and stare out into the desert and wonder why you're not further along in your fucking horrible tech career.
You shove cactus leaves up your ass and then you like do coffee extrude. Like,
yeah.
It's like a soft
trip. I want to have a breakthrough in Joshua. I'm going to take a bunch of shrooms and go to Joshua Tree. I want to have a breakthrough.
This one's
break your head.
Joshua Tree's where Steve Jobs went to decide to like die of cancer.
Yeah. Joshua Tree's where everybody was a breakthrough.
Yeah.
It's all these people that work for ICE taking shrooms, running around.
What if we give them hysterectomies?
Yeah. I figured out a way to design a better cage. I took so much DMT, I found out a better cage to put kids in. You fucking demons from hell.
I agree. Look, I think this woman needs to be sent. I think you need to report back. I think we need to get Carney's Airbnb rented
should
again.
I should unblock her and call her.
Yes. We call her. We get her in the thing, right?
I think we could get sued for that because it's recorded. I'm just saying. I'm not to ruin the fun.
What if we don't show her voice?
The how do we do that?
We can't record a conversation if they don't know it's being.
What if it's just your end?
But still, that's not going to. We need her.
We do, right? I mean, what, if you start threatening her, it will be fun.
She lives in California?
I believe so.
Okay, then yeah, we can't do it. Yeah. If she lived in Nevada or something like that.
Yeah, that's a lawyer, Ben.
Ben, why do you come in here and party pooper and destroy everything?
I'm a lawyer to protect you.
A good lawyer would tell us how to do what we need to do, not that we can't do it.
Yeah, I don't want to hear no's from you. I want to hear yes and how.
We could try to call her and say, hey, is it okay if we record this conversation?
Let's just do that.
Hold on. How do I? Can you unblock? Go find the numbers I blocked.
Just
can
leave
you do that.
Why don't we have Ben off the air? Just say, hey.
Why don't we call her and say, "Happy New Year"? We want to bury the hatchet.
Right. You're on a live stream, by the way. Is that okay?
You're on a live stream. We want to bury the hatchet. We're sorry.
Skull.
Shit, Tim. You have so many block numbers here.
I
you remember which one it is? Yeah. It's like 400.
I get into things with people. Oh my God. Oh my God, there's so many.
There's so many.
Who are you blocking?
Dude, there's so many people.
I've never blocked anyone.
No one calls you.
Good point.
It was a 415 number. I blocked someone. I didn't even unblock them. And I texted them the other day and then they didn't text me back. I'm like, fuck that person. They're blocked. I didn't even know that. Dude, there's.
Did you block Tino?
I think it's this one. So I'm going to unblock.
Okay.
I'm going to unblock. How do I do that?
Let me see.
It's not giving me an option. I believe it is. That is the number. And what do we call her? We say, what if we call her and just play Tina Pearl song, Better Life?
I think that's legal.
Is it illegal, Ben, if we just play her Tina Pearl song, Better Life?
If we record any of her on her end, well, we did the fake business thing. No one came after us.
Yeah, but there's a person he's threatened already.
Yeah, it's true.
No one threatened her.
Well, you just said you did.
I sent her a GIF of the Simpsons house burning, which I thought was funny. It's funny. The idea is that I'm going to burn down our house, which is a bitch.
I think it's deserved, but you know, I mean, some people might disagree.
Can we call Tina Parole? And get Tina Pearl's opinion.
What is with this? Like not responding to us directly.
She's responding to trolls in the comments.
This is that's not how you win, Tina. You don't win that way.
Okay. Tina,
I saved her name and I unblocked her.
I mean, so what do we do? Should I call her?
You can't have her.
Can
on
I
the
call phone. Her *67? I'm gonna call her *67. Right?
Yeah. Should we connect the Bluetooth real quick?
Yeah. Caller Ben, can you do this?
Yeah, I'll *67 her.
and save her in Star 67, or we'll call her. We're going to just ask her. She'll be on the show.
Right.
And defend her position.
So make sure we can't hear her until she agrees, or else we'll all be sued for everything we have.
I don't really need to get sued, but I do need justice.
No, don't turn it up.
What? Oh, you want
we have to wait her? Until she responds.
Okay, I'm going
to
have a private conversation with her.
Yeah.
Okay. Call her and ask her if she wants a better life. All we're trying to do is be honest here. I want to bury the hatchet.
Can't believe my grandparents got on a plane and they went to Luxembourg first.
What should I say?
They were debriefed by Langley.
Hold on. What do you mean? What should you say?
I'm going to have a private conversation with her before I connect her.
Hi, the guy that stayed on your Airbnb is famous comedian and wants to talk to you on his show right now.
There we go.
Yeah. You dumb bitch. You slippery whore.
Live on his live. Yeah.
Say Happy New Year. Maybe I should say it. Go Happy New Year. Do you feel the heat? That's your house burning down.
We can hear. Get away from the mic.
Okay.
That's all right. She's not going to answer.
This is nerve-wracking. Ben is currently facing the floor. He looks like you're wearing a dunce cap. All right.
She's not going to answer.
Anticlimactic.
Should we leave her a message, or is that considered harassment?
I think that might be used as evidence in the court of law. I'm just thinking ahead here.
You're right. You're trying to protect me.
Right.
You're trying to protect me, and I appreciate that.
No problem.
I totally understand that. Yeah. But we also understand. Do the people in the chat agree with us? Is there anything going on in the chat?
Let me see if I can open the chat.
That's not about questioning the the height of the smokestacks at Treblinka. Okay, we don't need that.
Let me get the chat up. I'll text them. 1 second.
The first few things in the chat are like, it was actually nowhere near 6 million.
Wait, did the chat on the live stream? Is that what's going on?
People are chatting. I'm sure they're chatting.
I'm getting the producers to send it to me.
I just wanted to know if there's anybody agreeing with this Airbnb slob. I'll go to war with this company. I'll go to war with Airbnb, and I'll go to war with these two women who think they're designers. You're nothing of the sort.
Right.
Stop claiming you spent years on your home.
I live in a place.
Yes, tell them.
Excuse me. I'm sorry, I don't try through.
Oh, here's the chat. They're going pretty crazy.
Please end this. You can eat Magic Spoon cereals. I actually called Joe Rogan. Somebody named Chris D'Elia says, give me a call to him. He was supposed to come over the other day and have lunch with us.
Yeah.
We're going to have Chris D'Elia over for lunch.
I lived in an apartment with bugs, garbage and bugs. Mice living in my shoes. And that was nicer than the Airbnbs where I was, you know.
I agree. All right, we don't have to live in the chat here.
Every second with these people.
I mean, but I'm just, everyone's always with, I'm raping you all the time.
Is that what they were saying?
I mean, it's the same bit.
No, it's not rape. It's, you know, it's like no one's fighting.
He's getting paid.
Yeah.
If I were to rape him, it's not even rape.
Right. Well.
Right?
Because he's your employee. Is that what you're
employed.
Saying? I'm not sure how it, like, in California, if that's the law. Other states,
I think it's our cultural law.
Okay.
In California. I'll tell you that much. If I hand you a check, you keep your mouth shut. Where do you stand on rape?
Yeah, I'm not a big
what
fan.
What do you think about 2021? I mean, it's been a rough year, 2020, for a lot of people. And what do you think? Are you hopeful about 2021?
Look, we got $600 in our pockets, right?
Yes.
And from the federal government. We have vaccine in our arm. It's going to give us jellyfish, I think.
There was a lot of stuff happening.
Tina 40 is going to live.
He goes, they're trying to find the Lazarus gene. I was like, all right, well.
Tina 40 is going to liberate the Walmart, I guess.
Alex Jones said that you're trying to find a Lazarus gene, which is a blob of cells that kills the host but lives forever.
Well, the blob does. It's like the blob.
Right, but what is...
I don't know what the fuck he was talking about the whole time.
It's very interesting, though.
It was dense.
It was engrossing.
Yeah.
He said this is why they're doing the vaccine to find this.
I bring up the Spear of Destiny, and he acts like, yeah, fuck you, that's the Spear of Destiny. I'm just trying to, you know, interject here.
Right.
He didn't like me.
I think he liked you. I don't know.
He tried to get me to show me.
It was a great interview. I think what he was saying. What he was saying about Sandy Hook stuff was interesting.
No, it was actually, that was actually some,
you know, you could see the humanity, even though a lot of people are like,
I think he's in pain.
He's in pain. I think he made a mistake there. And I think that mistake just took on a life of its own. And I don't know much about the inner.
No, sure. I can't break the timeline down.
I can't break the timeline.
I was busy at that time. I was busy with the serial killers of the morgue.
Right.
You know.
In 2010, Rebecca Skloot published The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks.
Is that Oprah?
A compelling, it looks like Oprah. Is that Oprah?
I think they made an HBO show starring Oprah.
And Rose Byrne?
Yeah.
Who's Rose Byrne? Is that the chick who Harvey Weinstein raped?
That's
Rose McGowan.
Yeah. I was like, Rose Byrne's the one from the movie with the, which she played Seth Rogen's wife.
Henrietta Lacks was a woman who unknowingly donated her cells to Hopkins in 1951, beginning what was the first and for many years the only human cell line to reproduce indefinitely. Her cells, known as HeLa cells for Henrietta Lacks, remain a remarkably durable and prolific line of cells used in research around the world. This guide addresses several important healthcare research and ethical themes addressed in the book and in the movie.
But like, what's the compelling thing about her? Like, here, take some of my cells. We're like, is her story actually interesting? Like her? I thought, you know, I'm just saying.
I guess.
Okay. Did she make them on purpose? Their cells grow that way? Like, I don't know. It seems like a weird thing to make a biopic about. I get if it was about like the scientists recreating the cells, but it's like just random. Whatever. I'm sure she's a great woman. I'm not trying to shit on Henrietta Lacks.
Yeah.
It just seems like an odd. They like to make these very personal biopics about like larger things. You know?
Yeah, I don't know. It's very interesting about her cells living on forever and why that would be. And
it's like X-Men shit.
Yeah, it's really strange.
I wonder if she got, you know, she should got cut. She should get, if they're making all this research out of her cells, she should get some like royalties.
I agree. Do you think Breonna Taylor's cells will live on?
That's
all right. Anyway, moving on. It's a joke. It's not on YouTube. Can't take it away. I mean, it's very strange. Yeah. Ben, what do you think? Are you excited about 2021? 2021 is going to be as bad or worse, by the way, than 2020. Not as bad.
Look,
folks, anyone thinking that like tomorrow things are going
to
be different?
I think that there's going to, again, the Tina 40 event when she, you know, goes to the mall and with pitchforks, like there'll be pockets of niceness.
Yes.
You know, but like it's going to be a drudge. It's going to be
and then 2022 is going to be great.
Yeah, we're all going to be fucking, sucking, doing heroin and drinking gin. It's going to be nice. All right.
It's going to be the French Revolution.
Yeah, we're all going to be going to the house at the top of Beverly Hills and Bezos's house. I mean, why not?
Why not?
Why not just get into a knife fight in the middle of a fucking, you know, a French restaurant?
I think what's coming is more horror, but then maybe an amazing period of like Renaissance, sure, where you'll have art and architecture and science and food. I mean, really none of that's going to happen.
Really good impressionists.
Yeah.
prop comics, you know, just a lot of just, you know, just benign political kind of, you know, commentary.
I know.
You know, that I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, it's going to be great. It's going to be great. Seen any fun comedy specials recently?
Because this is really over.
It's bad.
I mean, look, no one.
How about people who shoot their special in different cities? That's fun, huh?
Oh,
because it's like, oh, I'm in a new city. Because
sometimes
now
this joke works and
hey,
that one.
Hey, I'm in another, like Varga goes, I think that's a cool thing for to do.
Now, do you think that? You think it's cool that
like that?
This joke only works in Boston. Yeah. This one only works.
Hey, now I'm in Cleveland.
Yeah. That's some real.
I got on a plane. You didn't see it. Now I'm in a different place.
Now I'm eating. Now I'm eating cheesesteaks.
Oh boy. God.
It really is some mouth breather shit.
Yeah, it really is. But it's okay. To each their own. Michael liked that. He thought that was a fun concept.
Yeah. He also got a dog that fucking just wants to die.
This dog does look like you. Everyone, the comments, they say Duncan is Ray.
Yeah, look, I want to die too. I get it. But this is like, I feel like he's a tumor that came out of me.
he's the fucking Lazarus gene from your body. Ray comp cells reproduce to make Duncan. I mean, that's probably... He's like, look at you like that's my father.
I have to bring him back into my body.
Yeah. I just hope, in the Henrietta Lacks movie that she was played by Julia Roberts. She was played by Julia Roberts in blackface. to be Henrietta Lacks. Reese Witherspoon. Yeah, Reese Witherspoon. Henrietta Lacks, played by Reese Witherspoon.
So you're saying my genes are superior?
Reese Witherspoon doing a really offensive black accent. Yeah. So what you're saying is that I'm going to live forever? They're like, Reese, she's not from the South. What you're saying is that I'm going to be like Jesus? Reese, great job, Reese. You're doing a phenomenal job. I'm Henrietta Lacks. I'm Reese Witherspoon playing Henrietta Lacks. How about that? Me outside. Catch my cells outside. How about that? Where's Bad Baby spending New Year? Really nuke us.
Yeah.
Like if every, you had a great line the other day where on the phone you said, why doesn't every country in the world just call our bluff and nuke us at once?
Right.
Just
I mean,
would anything be funnier? Anything be better than every country in the world, even the little countries like one half a nuke can't even get here?
Yeah.
Just nuke in the general direction of the United States.
I couldn't have imagined a more unceremonious ending for what we've done to the world.
Yeah,
it's like a murderer, like it's like a serial killer. Then just kind of like becoming like a fucking paint addict.
It's like a guy. This is exactly what it is. It's a guy that spent his entire life killing women and children. Yeah. And then he like has a shitty job at Home Depot that he doesn't really like.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like there's no justice. It's just he's kind of sitting in his backyard. And he's like, yeah, this kind of sucks. I get it now. Right. Maybe I shouldn't have killed all those people. Right. Anyway, like that's the way the movie ends. The guy's like, I guess I shouldn't have killed all those people.
And he's like, drinking a margarita.
Yeah, he's just sipping some fucking white wine in his shitty backyard of his apartment by the train, by the railroad.
It ain't that great, is it?
Yeah, it's not that great. He goes, I get what the common man feels now. He goes, I was out there killing and raping and pillaging, but now I get it because the dollar is sinking. I can't get any overtime. I can't get a knee operation.
Eat a fucking shrimp taco.
Yeah, I mean that's where we're at. It's a real fun way to end.
Look, maybe we'll get some good movies. You've seen Tenet?
No,
that's great. Not really, but you know, it's like I'm saying, like Wonder Woman. We'll get some new Marvel stuff. Maybe
I just hope the next season of Ozark is about Marty and Wendy making a vaccine. Like, I just hope that the next season of Ozark is about Marty and Wendy just making batches of vaccine in their lake house in the Ozarks.
It didn't come out of a lamp. Shut up, Wendy.
they're done with laundering money. They're getting the bigger and better things.
Money laundering for saps.
Yeah. Yeah. They're taking on Moderna. Laura,
I mean, Lane. Honestly, can you? I mean, Moderna. I mean, I'll take the vaccine. I don't give a fuck. Whatever. I'll grow a jellyfish in my ass. I don't care. But like Moderna, it's not even like a real name. It wasn't.
No, all the names are just like it's like all the names.
Futury.
Yeah.
Newish.
Yeah. Newish. Futury.
It's just like no one's even trying. I mean, honestly,
remember in the beginning of COVID when Trump brought out all the CEOs and one was like, it was like CEO of Buffalo Wild Wings. Trump's like the CEO of Sleepy's Mattress has promised he's going to give pillows to people that are dying or whatever. And
David Buster's going to give cups to.
Yeah.
When he comes.
Yeah. The CEO of Wendy's giving everyone a Frosty if they make it to week two with COVID. Remember that?
The purchase of a cheeseburger.
Yeah. Right. You have to purchase a cheeseburger from your hospital bag.
We're on a scam here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're a business.
Yeah. So he brought it. And that, like you said, public health in America will just get taken over by a succession of businesses.
I mean, look, go overseas. Like no one's pretending anymore.
Yeah.
Like no one, I don't know who is looking like, oh, we should come to America and thinking like, but they tricked us into coming. Like we've been telegraphing for years that it's over. Yeah. I don't know what you think is like, I mean, look, Epstein was the moment, if not any, 9/11 at least was complicated.
Right.
At least they put some effort in.
Yeah.
But like Epstein was just like, yeah, the guy who, you know, he lived with the guy in his cell was the guy who wanted the ex-cop and he's a big dude. What was
it? Yeah, 9/11, they tried Epstein. They're like, we are.
The cameras are all broken. Yeah. The fucking,
like, everybody's asleep.
It's like they want us to know. They're saying Mitch McConnell, whoever's running this shit, is going, please kill us. Revolt. Can you? We want this then. We're immortals. Yeah. We live forever. We're bored. Just kill us.
Yeah, they're like, what can we do to get you people to leave your houses with weapons? Tell us what we have to do. You can still buy weapons.
Maybe we'll give them COVID and they'll get so, you know, cabin fever that they'll actually break out. No.
No. Final thoughts. Tina 40. Ben, do you have any final thoughts for the new year?
For the new year? The only suggestion is I wanted Ray to sing the Bobby Short song, if that was okay to close us out.
Oh, yeah. Can you sing Bobby Short?
I don't know the words, but yeah.
I have the lyrics.
Okay. Yeah. The Bobby Short, because it's You Love New York.
Right.
You know the Bobby Short song?
I know, yeah. We were talking about this a bunch of times. Okay. Is it a karaoke we're doing?
We picture Ray singing this in a white suit.
Does it be it's be karaoke?
We picture you singing this in a white suit at the Carlisle and the people are there with their children. It's by Christmas time and everyone's swaying and kind of looking at you and they're excited and you're just singing it and everyone loves you.
Right.
So there's no instrumental version of this I could find anywhere.
Well, I'll sing along, but
you'll just sing over it. Yeah.
No, are there words?
He's
got to get the lyrics.
It's loading. Okay. 1 second, Ray. Let me start this.
Karaoke would be a lot better, Ben.
Yeah. This is kind of a weird setup.
I know there's no karaoke version.
You could have. Yeah. I'm sure it exists.
Okay.
Come on.
I just said on Instagram he's the best podcast producer in LA. Now this is.
Did you? Why would you say that?
Because I was trying to pump him up, but then he gets so high. No,
he only does well when he's looking
he
up.
Really now. Only he only does well when he's being beaten.
I happen to like New York. I like the town. I like the city. Yeah, I like to drink of it. The more I see New York, the more I think of it. I like the sight and the sound, even the stink of my ass.
I happen to like New York.
I like to go to Battery Park and fuck some old.
I often ask myself why
I met a woman named Henrietta Lacks. She has cells that reproduce.
We happen to like New York. Last Sunday afternoon, I took a trip to Hackensack. I tried to get the girl to lick my sack. I took the train back. My mom was getting fucked in the ass.
And then we went to see Tina Parole.
I happen to like this town.
Then I punched her in the face, and now she's my wife.
I happen to like
New York.
I happen to like
vaccines. Great job. Well, folks, that's 3 hours. Tina 40, Alex Jones, no Tina Parole. Very sad.
It's her fault.
She missed her chance. She is now responding to comments on Instagram.
Yeah, well, respond. Why don't you respond to failure?
Tell the people where they can find you in 2021.
At Twitter and Instagram, at Ray Kump. Listen to Kump Podcast. It's on YouTube and anywhere you get podcasts. It's amazing. It's time for the Patreon. We got a lot of great things going. Also, listen to Our Love is Disgusting with me and Lucy Steiner.
The Tim Dillon Show on... everything. And then, you know, we've got a lot of fun stuff coming up. We hope we'll see. And thank you everybody for tuning in. We had a great time. We hope you enjoyed bringing in the new year with us. Tina 40, Alex Jones.
Happy New Year, Tim.
Happy New Year. What an unceremonious, what a truly unceremonious end this country is having. A truly unceremonious end this country is having.
That's what we deserve.
It's exactly what we deserve, to die with boredom. Yeah. To just go, I'm sick of the lockdowns and I'm sick of the vaccine. Like, I'm just bored already. I'm bored.
Let's go storm a Costco.
Yeah, let's go. Yeah, that's the only thing we can do in a revolutionary spirit in this country is run into Starbucks and scare people. That's all that we can do
in this COVID, bitch.
Yeah. We're weaponizing our own disease. We enjoy the bioweapon China sent, and now we're trying to give it to each other in a Walmart.
We're monsters.
And that's where America is. It is a horror movie that will not end, but this show is. Good night.
Night.